Ladies and gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
Time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show! Built by the Barndominium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chiefs Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure! Penny just dives in!
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Signarama Studios, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks, signarama.com, Gamecock owned and operated, located in West Columbia, South Carolina. Built by the Barndo Co., where you can build your dream home for as low as $160 per square foot. Yep, that's right. They build dream homes all over the Carolinas. And in Tennessee and in Georgia. And my goodness, if you haven't seen the designs for some of these things, go to the barndominiumco.com. If this is something that's on the agenda or on the docket down the road for you, you might want to check it out. It is really, really neat what they can do. They can literally do anything. They can do anything that you want. And it's the coolest home design out there. And there's a reason why they are one of the nation's best builders. That's right. The Barn Dominium Company. And one of the nation's best bourbons is from Chicken Cock, and we are glad to have them as a partner as well, serving our programming here on Inside the Gamecocks. Mad Dog and myself, to begin, JC will join us in a little bit. He's was caught in some traffic trying to get home, and so we'll get him in just a little bit. We'll also get Stuart Lake in about 15 minutes as well. Carolina hits the road today. It's a travel day. They'll practice tonight in T-Town, and they will begin a three-game series with the Tide tomorrow. Their third SEC series, Carolina hoping to kind of reverse course on the road, just 1-9 in their last 10 road series in league play. We'll talk to him about all that, including the pretty wild 19-14 victory last night over Presbyterian at Founders Park. We do have Derek Scott at the end of the program today as well. He'll recap basketball season, touch on some baseball as well. And Matt Anderson will join us from 12 to 2. I actually have to dip out of here at 12. I've got a meeting to get to, but these guys are more than capable, of course, of taking you home. Tomorrow will be our last day of the work week. We will take Good Friday off and enjoy it with our families, and we hope that you all will do the same. The Sweet 16, Phil, is set to go tomorrow. We've got mock drafts that are out as well. Shane Beamer had a great 40-minute interview or so with Josh Pate. If you haven't had a chance to check that out, he was really open about his process and hiring football coaches. And I found that a refreshing answer when he was asked about it by our buddy Josh Pate, who's got one of the best programs out there. Got another transfer from football, and we got another transfer from basketball. So a lot of stuff to get through, no doubt about it. And it is raining, and that kind of sucks too. Good morning.
Yeah. Good morning. Rain cleared out up here, so don't worry. Blue skies are coming. And yeah. Hey, I want to wish my wife a happy birthday.
All right.
Happy birthday, Dina. Yes. I will not reveal how old she is, but she doesn't look a day over 27. I'll put it that way.
That's right. Mm-hmm. You get that right. Well, happy birthday, Dina.
Yeah.
Do y'all have any plans?
We actually went out to eat. It's dance night up here tonight. So we went out to Miyabi last night, to a little Japanese steakhouse action. Yeah, it was fun. It was a good time. Mm-hmm.
We've been talking about trying to get the kids to our version of that. here, and we haven't been able to do it. But anyways, we want them to see the flames and the fire and
enjoy it all. I know. Yep. It's fun. The kids love it, and hey, the food's good. So, well worth it. Had a great time last night. Had a great time. But happy birthday, baby.
Happy birthday, no doubt about that. Speaking of fire, 19 runs last night for the Gamecocks against the Blue Hose of Presbyterian, but they gave up 14. They did win on the way to Tuscaloosa, Alabama. A tough night on the mound. Their worst night by far of the season. These things happen. But you don't want to see them happen. Roman Kimball continues to struggle. They got to figure him out. They'll get him figured out at some point in time. They tried to get him some innings early last night when, you know, Carolina had a little bit of a buffer there after scoring 7 runs in the first inning off of Blue Hose starter Tristan McGregor. But he didn't have it. And then after that, neither did Michael Polk or Jake McCoy getting their first action of the year. Sam Simpson, who doesn't throw often, he didn't have it either. So, those guys collectively, there were 8 walks issued by them. Eddie Copper on the mound, a rough start as well for the freshman. It was one of those nights where you wanted to get as much work as you can for guys that need the work if you can score the runs. Carolina certainly did that by pounding out 15 hits and 6 home runs, including a pair from Dalton Reeves, the transfer from Presbyterian, a catcher really getting his first real time of the year. And he had a couple of 3-run dingers that probably haven't landed yet.
No.
Carolina did get out of there, and that's what you want to do sometimes in these wacky midweek games. It literally happens all over the country every week. It's crazy to see some of it. How about the Florida Gators? Now, I know they got beat by Florida State last night, but they've also lost to teams this year named St. John's and St. Mary's and Jacksonville in the midweek. Not power programs by any stretch of the imagination. Gators already have 10 losses on the year. Carolina, though, improves to 20-5 after the victory last night, and they ended up throwing 9 arms, including Chris Beach, who came in to get the final out, and I think he threw like 1 pitch.
But it was 4, but yeah, I was counting. I was like, because at that point I was already disappointed. This game should have ended an hour ago in the middle of the 7th, but the bullpen let us down and they ended up scoring more runs to clear the 10. Yeah. But when Veach came in, it was, change up, wild pitch. Cause I was like, okay, 3 pitches and we're out of here. Then he, rang it back in for the ground out to end the game. So 4 pitches for Mr. Veach.
Yeah. 4 pitches. So he got his midweek work in. He threw a little bit of a bullpen by getting loose. He got out there, faced a batter or two, and now they're off to T-Town where he will pitch in Tuscaloosa against the Alabama Crimson Tide this week. Ranked number 16, Carolina ranked number 18 by D1 Baseball. Got a athlete sighting in the Nana Sports chat box today. Oscar Attaway, the transfer running back from the Mean Green of North Texas, has graced us with his presence. Glad to see you. Hope you're enjoying Columbia, South Carolina. I hope you're enjoying the football program and the University of South Carolina.
Yeah, I thought he was a third. Maybe I'm wrong. I thought the player was the third. Maybe this is his father. Yeah.
It might be.
Yeah. See, okay. Yeah. That's the chat box is correct.
That's his dad.
Well, okay. Either way, welcome home. Happy to have everybody here.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Fantastic. So that's his dad. That's not the actual, that's not his. We're clear this up for me. Yeah. Have I confused myself?
Yes. Oscar Attaway the third. Is the running latest back. Transfer running back.
This is his father who's in the chat.
I would assume that Oscar Attaway Jr. here in the chat box is
okay. His that would make sense, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm not as dumb as I look, Mr. Attaway. I assure you of that. So glad to have you. I was confused by what was going on, but certainly glad to have you and hope you'll download the Chief Sports app. You can take us anywhere you want. And at some point in time, I'm sure your son will come up on this program and we'll make sure it's good. I can assure you of that. Yeah. it was a lot of runs and a rain delay. On that note, hats off to our buddy Grayson Griner. He was spectacular in the booth. I texted him last night and told him he did a wonderful job with Dave Weinstein on the SEC Network Plus. Obviously, great. I think Grayson's going to come pop in next week and talk some Gamecock baseball with us. As a former big league catcher, me being a catcher, we're on the same wavelength about a lot of things. Catchers are great in the booth because they see everything and they can feel the game, and you generally can feel that the way that they describe it and discuss it. And I thought he did an excellent job up there last night with Dave. So hats off to Grayson Griner. I know he's hoping to get some more games on TV, and I'm sure that he will after his performance. So that was the good, but the bad were all the walks issued by the staff last night. But again, we got Coach Lake coming up in just a little bit. Bunch of dudes who are out there working on things, trying to get stuff figured out. You hate to see that. Don't get me wrong, but you hate to lose the game even more. And they didn't. They didn't. They scored 19 runs. That's their 11th game in double figures of 25 played this year, which is not too shabby for an offense, really, for a while. They just could not swing it well with the runners on base. They have scored 59 runs in their last five games. That's 11.8 runs per game in the last five. And remember, three of those five include teams include a team named the Vanderbilt Commodores, who were ranked third in the country at the time in lieu of that, or on the way to the sweep of those guys at Founders Park. Also, in the last five games, they've hit 16 home runs. So the long ball has returned to an offense that we thought would hit it well, and they certainly have been doing that. Petrie once again goes yard twice last night, and he's kind of getting into the groove now of the Ethan Petrie that we really thought that we would see sooner. But as Coach Kingston pointed out last week, he had to adjust to the adjustments that were made to him. He's a sophomore now. The book was out, and he has done that. And now he is swinging .345 on the year with 12 home runs and 26 RBI. The home run total is up to 43 for an offense that's total batting average has climbed to .282 as well. With all that said, I think most importantly coming from the game last night is the fact that Kennedy Jones is okay. The ball that plunked him in the helmet.
That was scary.
So that was a really, really strange sequence there with the kid that they brought in. And let me tell you why. Because his name escapes me, but he only faced, I think, two hitters. And he threw a fastball at 83 miles an hour, middle in to Messina, and it was a strike. And Cole Messina, if you throw him an 83-mile-an-hour fastball middle in, it's generally not going to stay in the ballpark very long. It's just not. And you could tell when he took the pitch that it was either a, wow, didn't expect that, was looking for something else, or didn't see it well. The next pitch was a breaking ball, and he was late on that, and it was a hanger. And so I thought to myself, you know, this guy hides it well. There's something going on here. You know, it's one of these guys who throws mid-80s, which is nothing, but they hide it well, so they're able to get guys out. And clearly at that point in time, you know, PC was down a bunch, and I'm sure this guy doesn't get a ton of innings, so they were probably trying to get him in there and get him some work. And then when Kennedy comes up, the ball that hit him in the helmet, you know, it looked like it was 100, but it wasn't. I think it was 84, 85-mile-an-hour fastball. Not that that would feel good. It wouldn't. But he didn't see it either. So, clearly this guy, again, A, doesn't get a ton of innings, and B, he was hiding it very well. And so those guys just were not seeing it. The cap to all of this, if you happen to be watching the game, and no offense, Coach Lake, and no offense to my man Derek, both of them on the show today, but I didn't listen last night. I was watching, so I wanted to listen to Grayson in his debut on the SEC Network. The cap to all of that is the mics that are very misplaced for these TV broadcasts. One of the mics caught Coach Pollock, the head baseball coach for the Hoes, who turned to his pitching coach and said, "Get him the blank out of there." uh,
Yeah, I'd say after, you know, plunking two in a row, it's like, yeah, get him the blank out of there.
Yeah, he wasn't happy. And Elton Pollock is a great guy. He's been at PC for like 20 years. He's a great guy. They haven't had a ton of success. It's hard to there. I know Coach Corbin, you know, certainly had some success there, but he was not thrilled. He was just not thrilled, and because he hit Messina. Remember, he hit Messina too on that mm-hmm. fastball that hit him on the upper thigh, like, and it bounced off. Like, Messina is, you know, he's built like a brick house. So he goes to first, and then that ball that hit Kennedy in the head, it was dangerous, but also he had plunked the first two guys that he saw, and Tim Corbin or Elton Pollock was he had had enough. Yeah. So he walked over there to make sure that Kennedy was okay. Obviously out there with Coach King and Monty. And then you could hear it, get him the blank out of there. And they did. They made a change.
And just like that, he was gone.
and then that young man, he was done. So yeah, my gut tells me he's going to have some work to do to get back into the ball game for the Blue Hose down the road. But anyways,
yeah.
All right. It's 11-19. Yeah, John, that's right. Yeah. Coach Pollock, he's been the head coach there for, I think 20 years or so, somewhere in there. It was right around when I was graduating high school. So when he got hired, if I remember correctly, but great, great guy. They recruited me a little bit and I wasn't interested, but great dude who does a lot for a lot of people. There's no doubt about that. All right. It's 11-19. It is Wednesday. It's hump day, March the 27th. JC will be back here in just a few minutes, but when we return, I just mentioned Coach Lake. He'll join us a couple of days early, generally on Fridays, but we've got him today before they hit the road for T-Town right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpepper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, three great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
The season rolls on at Love Chevy, where the inventory is overflowing and the deals are in full bloom. Rev up your season with Love's exclusive specials on Suburbans, Tahoes, Silverados, Trailblazers, and the ever-popular Chevy Trax. They're hard to find. At Love Chevy, get behind the wheel and feel the possibilities. New adventures, new destinations, just you and the open road. Act now for Springtacular Savings at Love Chevrolet. The best selection of new Chevys. The lowest price, guaranteed. The other dealers upsell, overcharge, and will say most anything to get the sale. At Love Chevy, satisfied customers say it all. Things like helpful, knowledgeable, honest, and fun. Your trusted hometown Chevy dealer since 1961. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
That's the power.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock Nation, my name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever, and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to mckellarenterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks.
And we welcome you to Founders Park. It's time for baseball, folks. Drive, left field, way back, and gone. Hits the ball into the air the opposite way. Has he done it twice? Yes, he has.
Now get to left. Taylor to the wall. It's gone. Back-to-back home runs for South Carolina.
There's a high drive.
What else can this young man do, Derek? My goodness, that ball was killed.
This is Ethan Petrie from Gamecock Baseball. You are now listening to Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Be loud. Go Gamecocks.
Presented by Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com.
It's 11:24, RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Resto Pros of the Midlands presents our coverage of Gamecock baseball all season long here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show, part of the Chief Sports Network. Four boxes now. JC is back, and there is Coach Lake, who's getting ready to ride to T-Town tomorrow. Now, I'm going to ask you this, because we asked Whittle the other day, and he had never heard of it. You've got to have heard of it as many times as you played in Tuscaloosa. Have you ever eaten at City Cafe in Northport?
No, I haven't.
Man, what is going on here?
You got to – well, here's why I don't leave the hotel very much. When I
right.
So managers bring food to the hotel typically, and that's what I eat. You get, my diet on the road is very bland. I eat a lot of peanut butter, I eat a lot of crackers, and that's about it. I don't have a – I'm not one of those, let's go try something at a restaurant when I was coaching.
Well, but Derek's a restaurant guy, though. So how, all right, do me a favor. So y'all get there tomorrow. You won't have time to do this tomorrow.
Yeah.
Maybe Friday morning or Saturday morning, just ride over the little bridge like Columbia to West Columbia, go over to Northport,
yeah,
and eat City Cafe. Now, they're you know Catfish. We've had this conversation because you spent all that time in Oxford. They've got, I mean, spectacular catfish. But they also have incredible, good homemade biscuits in the morning, like sausage biscuits and stuff. Everything on the menu is fantastic. It's a staple. City Cafe in Northport.
And Derek's been there? I'll have to ask.
Oh, I don't know if he's been there. Yeah. I don't know. But if he hasn't, see, this would be a great opportunity for you two to bond, you know, like over a piece of sausage or something, get to know each other a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. More hours with Derek. So let me think. I've only got 15 hours in the car. Three games should be about, I don't know, let's say roughly 10 hours. Yeah. I think we could squeeze in another good 2 hours of bonding. That
should be fine. Bonding time. Hey, it closes really at 3:30.
Relationship.
So you know the breakfast and the catfish have to be legit if they close at 3:30. They don't need dinner rush.
Yeah.
So we got a quick.
I just correct. Looked it up because I was worried for a second the place had closed and Jamie's sitting there talking about it. So I had to look it up, but it is still open. Yeah, they're just open for breakfast and lunch.
So, yeah, they close at 3:30. We gotta give Quantrell. Quantrell's my guy. He's my guy. I love Quantrell. Y'all know this. Gotta give him a little lesson here, though. Catfish is not seafood. Catfish is not found in
catfish
the sea.
Is not seafood.
So it's like, you know, Quantrell, if you're getting oysters out of the, you know, the local pond or something, I wouldn't eat those. It's kind of the same thing. If they tell you that it is catfish that came from like the Atlantic Ocean, they are lying. I can prove it. So anyways, all right, man. So here we are, 33 runs later after this It was just, you know, you get one of these every, you get the rain and then nobody throws strikes and you're like, okay, we're going to get a 10 run rule. No, we're not. We're going to be here even longer, but you got to win those two. Yeah. And they did.
Well, what they've done so far is just really have taken care of business non-conference. Obviously you dropped two to Clemson, but I don't really just consider those your non-conference, although they are. So you wish you could get one of those back. Lost one to Belmont. And that's been it. So if you somehow, you know, keep this trend up, you got a chance of really putting yourself in a position to be a host at the end of the year. That was always one of our things. So, but no, last night, I mean, I'm sure if y'all listen to us at all, Derek and I both said, it's amazing that umpires refuse to call strikes in the last 2 years. It's like they had a meeting and someone said, you must call so-and-so number of balls per game because – Dan McDonald told me the other day, he goes, Stu, our game's on the way to being a seven-inning game. If we don't do something in baseball right now, college baseball, to speed it up, it hasn't affected Major League Baseball. Major League Baseball, you can watch a game now under 3 hours because they've just – they have the best umpires in the world. They've got the timing, and it moves. We don't have that. We're expecting a guy that's not at that level to be working at their level. And we're just sitting there last night. I think I had a pitch count going. It was like 500 pitches or something.
Yeah.
I don't know how you could answer or expect a fan to keep watching or stay there. And that was – I'm an offensive guy, so I should be jumping up and down today with that many hits and that many runs. It wasn't. And I don't – this isn't South Carolina related. I'm just disappointed for our college baseball right now that no one else is – jumping up and down, making a big enough deal. Look at the home runs. I mean, the home runs are coming from that. And it just kind of keeps going, eh, well, we'll see. Is how I feel a lot of time with the national media with it.
This is back-to-back weeks. You know, we actually talked to Coach Holbrook last week, and he said the exact same thing. He's frustrated. You know, they're tired of it. They're tired of it. And I was asking him about – the long ball, you know, because Petrie's moving up the list right now. He had two more last night. He's climbing it. And then I mentioned to Chad, I said, you know, had they not just totally deflated the bats when they did, Christian Walker would be substantially higher on that home run list at South Carolina. So I just kind of asked him where he thought the game was, and he said, all right, I'm gonna go on a soapbox here. And he went the same route with the umpires. You mentioned Dan McDonald. I mean, we've heard King say it. I've heard Sully say it. I mean, these are guys, like, I mean, these are dudes. Like, these are the dudes of Corbin said it. These are the dudes of college baseball. Why is nobody listening?
I really don't get it. And, you know, we had the very first media kind of Zoom call. Ben McDonald just really said a lot. Said, this is ridiculous. Why are we not? And the SEC head of umpires, Paul Gillier, looked right at him on the Zoom and said, no, the strike zone hadn't changed, Ben. And Ben McDonald got furious. He goes, Paul, how can you sit here and say that? Are you even watching the games? And, oh, no, we haven't changed the strike zone. We're just holding them to a tighter rope, you know. And Ben McDonald was like veins in his neck. And I'm sitting here going, okay, here's a guy that people listen to. But since that point, I mean, it why I bring all of it up, it really is amazing for our pitching staff. Yep. When you our numbers to think in an era where we've walked, I'm looking at my numbers here, we've walked 197 times offensively.
Yeah.
One in the country, it's number one in the SEC. Then to turn around and think as a pitching staff, we walked 94. That puts us at like eighth in the league. So, I mean, the numbers are incredible. We've taken advantage of it. Mm-hmm. I think as we've talked on here, it's hurt our hitters at times. I thought last weekend they got way more aggressive because Vanderbilt's pitchers were so in the zone that it allowed you to be more aggressive. But last night against PC, I mean, after it was sometimes hard to swing, you know, to just stand there. I counted 9 balls that bounced to the plate at one time. So, I mean, you can ask a guy to swing at those. He won't be more aggressive. I mean, literally bounced. So it's a weird game right now, pitching-wise. And I think Matt Williams is doing an incredible job maintaining the balance of it from a team that walks a lot to a team that don't walk guys a lot.
God, there are so much to pack into this next question. I got to figure out how to ask it here, but you're dead on with Matt. He's got a science and he's got a calculator with every guy on his staff, and he is developing and teaching and doing all the things. I mean, we're baseball guys, so we see it a little bit differently than maybe somebody sitting in the stands might. We see the struggles. You can tell what some of these guys are trying to do, what they're trying to work through. Thus far, it's worked. They're one of the top. I don't know if they're still in the top three, but going into last night, they had the third best ERA in all of it, the entire nation. With that said, and then you've got this strike zone issue where they're just not calling strikes for whatever reason. You've got some guys who have unreal potential. And we'll start with the two who got some action last night, Jake McCoy and Michael Polk. Not good outings for either one of those guys. I think that was McCoy's second appearance, and that was Polk's first. But those guys have a lot of potential, and my understanding of this, Coach, and you stop me here if I'm incorrect, but my understanding is they're trying to get them where they need them to be in about a month or so to help them down the stretch. So what did you see out of those guys and what they can continue to build on that can help this program make a big run here over the next couple of months?
Yeah, I mean, McCoy's a guy you just want to have that one more arm out of the bullpen. He came in at Ole Miss. When they brought him in, it was that game two when they were just that eight-run inning. Dwight Gooden could have came in that inning and got hit. Ole Miss was just locked in at that point. As you kind of look through what they're trying to do is, as I told Derek last night, if you can add one more piece is the big thing you're trying to add right now. You're not trying to oversell it, but, man, you can get just a couple more arms in that bullpen because you're wanting to try to figure out, you know, what is going on with Roman. As I left last night driving home at 11:30 after the game, that's the one that jumps out to me is that's the guy I feel like you got to get going to really get where you think's the next level. Kimball's just too good to just say, he's not that guy. We just got to figure out what it's just the fat and say it's just the fastball. That's huge. But it's not the breaking ball that's the issue. It's the fastball in the strike zone. And when he throws it in the strike zone, his breaking ball is not a very easy to hit pitch. But, you know, what we got to do with Polk is he was just – that was his first time. You could see, I said on the radio, he was smiling on the mound, just so happy to be back on the mound. Mm-hmm. So I didn't put very much stock into anything last night. He's a veteran. He was 93-94, and he looked like – he just looked so happy to be out there competing. I would put more value in his second appearance than that one last night.
100% agree with that. 1,000% agree. And Jake McCoy's got Grayson Griner, very good. Very good, by the way, in the booth for GG. Great guy and did a wonderful job. And he hit the nail on the head. Don't you love catchers talking baseball, Coach? He said, man, it ain't the stuff. This guy's got the stuff. He's just got to learn to pitch at this level. Yep. And I thought that was a great comment for that young man because he's very young. He's a freshman. Remember, a late commitment to Coach King in this program. Kimball is an interesting case, and he's getting a lot of attention from the fan base because he was very highly regarded. We all know what he went through in trying to come back from his injury and things like that. I've spoken with Roman Kimball numerous times. He's a good kid, and he really, really, really is working hard, not just for himself but for this baseball team, and trying to get out there and make a difference. 17 walks in 13 innings obviously is about four times as the amount of walks that you really want there. So I'm with you. I wonder when he will get that next opportunity, you know, because you're going on the road in the league and high leverage situations. You can't put a guy in there who can't throw strikes. So, you know, he's talk about that as a coach. I mean, you've been through this as a head coach. You keep putting them out there. You give these guys opportunities, but at some point in time, either somebody else is going to step into that role or you're going to pitch yourself out of getting more opportunities, and those things are going to start to diminish. So he's starting to, you know, kind of get into a time frame here where he needs to start putting up some numbers.
I agree. And I know they're probably having the conversations. I've had them with guys before. You sit them down and go, look, you know, one day you're going to have a mortgage at the end of the month. Every month is due. So if you want to call that pressure, then that's pressure. You can't keep expecting to pitch and not perform. So if you want to call that, I'm putting pressure on you, that's fine. Call it pressure. But if you're going to have to perform at some point, because as I look at these stats, there are a lot of other guys who've gotten those chances, and they ain't going to give them up. I mean, if we came in, I was picking on Matt Williams last night because Matt had made a comment to me that some scouts don't like the way Gainey acts. I said, okay, who cares? Let's not get into all that. But let me tell you how pro baseball works. They're going to sit down in a room at the end of the year, and they're going to look at these numbers. He's got a zero ERA. I'm just using the ones right now, just in SEC play, you know, and their scout director's going to go, why the heck is Garrett Gainey not on your list? Mm-hmm. Do you really think a scout's going to say, well, he does a drop kick and a machine gun at the end when he throws, and that guy's going to say, okay, put Garrett Gainey's name on the list and take his name off, because we obviously don't need this guy scouting. Because And I was laughing because these guys get their chance. Any of us think Garrett Gainey was going to be the dude? He's the dude right now. He has allowed Veach to become the extended relief guy and not the closer, even though Veach had to be the closer last night. But Gainey was shut down last night because they wanted to give him a night off. So, I mean, you're saying is Roman Kimball's got to realize, hey, we're not just going to better keep giving you these things. I don't know when he'll get back in. I know when he gets back in, you got to throw some strikes. That's the key, you know?
Yep. There's no doubt. And hey, look, you know, if there's a scout out there that doesn't like the way that somebody acts, Carolina, they can control that. So, you know, they can shut that down. I mean, he doesn't probably need to be doing machine gun kicks after saving a game, but they can stop that. And I hope that they do, to be honest with you, but that's me talking, not you. All right,
love it and hate it at the same time. I mean, you know, like there's that old school image. It's just like, all right, this is a business trip. Let's just get off the mound and get back in the dugout. But then at the other side of it is, it was like, way to go, young dude.
Well,
you really are killing it out there. I get it. You got to respect the game and all that, but not being excited for him.
I hear where you're coming from on that. I disagree, and I'll tell you why I disagree. Because that stuff bites you in the ass in this game.
No, you it act can. Like that. Yeah.
Oh, next time you walk out there and you get embarrassed, nobody cares about your machine gun kicks. And it happened at Clemson when he skipped around the mound and then the ball left the yard.
Yeah.
You know, at some point in time, you got to learn from these things. But anyways, I don't want to get too bogged down in that. His kid does have an electric arm and he is going to be a huge, huge piece for South Carolina. You don't want, to your point though, Phil, to your point, and I would imagine Coach Lake would agree with this. You don't want to take a part of who he is away from him. That will diminish what he's capable of doing. But how do you control some of that?
Yeah.
So anyways, all right. On the offensive side, there's old Ethan Petrie. He sure has looked pretty good the last few games. So what are you seeing in his at-bats up there?
Well, it's kind of going back to what you were saying with Grayson Griner about McCoy, the stuff's there, and I learned to use it. I just see Ethan Petrie has become a really good hitter who now hits for power. Some of his hardest hit balls this year have been base hits. They've been doubles. They haven't all been home runs, but his home runs, they're just noticeable. He don't hit wall scrapers. He don't hit that ball that you go, that's high. Is it far? Oh, it's like 106, 111, and just so strong from right center to left center. I'm just impressed by him and his, you know, every home run, he's just passed so-and-so, and you start hearing names that you go, wow, this guy's not halfway through his sophomore year, and he's on this pace. Dealt with a little bit of an injury in the last week. I kind of joked with Derek last night. I'll be shocked if he's not DH'ing this weekend because I really like that outfield, but that'll come down to, you know, it's Kennedy Jones. How's he feeling after last night? Because that was a scary moment, the hit-by-pitch last night. So I don't know how he's responding today. I don't know if he's in a, you know, some type of protocol. I don't know. I haven't asked, and to be honest, until I'm told, I won't ask. But I really liked that outfield last year or last weekend running around with Ethan DHing because Ethan did so well DHing. So I think you found some new variables you can get in right now.
Yeah, I agree with that. His at bats are. You, Coach Kingston said something last week that that really did make a whole heck of a lot of sense. I mean, he was the new guy on the block last year. He walked into the ballpark every week. Nobody'd seen him. Yeah, sure, they'd seen film and had analytics and this, that, and the other. But guy steps in the box a little bit different. Book was out. You know, everybody adjusted to Ethan Petry, and he had to make some adjustments back. And there were some things he was doing early in the season, not to bog down too much into that, that I thought he probably needed to correct a little bit. He was missing fastballs. He ain't missing them now, no. Like you just pointed out. The situation when Messina got plunked and then Kennedy got plunked last night, I texted you. And I knew you were busy. You know, you talking on the radio. You had a job to do, so I figured we weren't going to sit there and have a conversation. But what did it look like from upstairs? Because neither one of those guys was seeing the ball out of his hand. Was he hiding it well? He wasn't throwing hard. What could you tell up there?
Well, the weird thing about that whole inning is the catcher for PC, they didn't send anyone out to catch the guy. So he gets to the mound as he's coming in, and he just stands there. Now, there's supposed to be a 2 minute and 30 seconds between innings. And so I'm saying on the radio, like, hey, we're getting under a minute and a half. This kid hadn't even thrown a pitch yet on the mound. So finally the catcher runs out. The umpire doesn't even ask anyone to hustle out there. And this kid throws five really quick warm-up pitches and tries to get them in. And then just when he pitched, and I said on the air, I mean, Elton Pollock, man, I tipped my hand to him. He took him right out of the game after.
Yeah.
Because, one, that kid was shaken up, I know. Two, you certainly don't want a third guy to get hit after you've hit two guys. So I just thought that was professional as heck by Elton. But I'll be honest, it was just such a herky-jerky delivery. It almost felt like a guy that wasn't quite ready to go. And when he did, he hits your top two guys. And the one that hit Kennedy Jones, I never looked up to see the velo on it, but the sound was scary. Yeah. And, you know, just the way as he stood up. You know, guys really want to jump up. They always want to jump up. Everybody clap and say, he's all right. He didn't jump up. He kind of stood up. And as he stood up, you could see he wasn't comfortable. And the trainer did a great job, let him go all the way to first, you know, let him run down the line. As he ran down the line, as soon as he got back to first, whatever was said by the trainer ended with, we're coming out of the game. And I noticed they took him straight up. I'm sure had him checked last night. I said on the air, I've had concussions. I grew up in an era where, you know, how many fingers am I holding up? I don't like that stuff. So I was so glad last night that he was just taken immediately out of the game. There would have been zero reason for him to stay in that game at that point. I'm just hoping that all the testing and everything, he's ready to go this weekend.
Yeah, I hope so. He is a, you know, if baseball was more like a street fight, the two guys you probably don't want to hit back to back in this lineup are Cole Messina and Kennedy Jones. Messina's the ball I've rolled about halfway to first base after it hit his thigh. I thought, good God, that dude is just built like he's a machine. All right. Speaking of Cole hitting in the two hole, you know, they feel like they've kind of found something there. I mean, this team scored 59 runs now in its last five games. Yeah. That's almost 12 a game. They've hit in the last five games. They've also hit 16 home runs. It's pretty good. But in the leadoff spot is a guy named Parker Nolan, who's hit safely in 11 of the last 12. He was 0-for-3 in that 8-3 victory on Saturday over the Commodores. I do that every time. I always mean Commodores with the most respect. But he settled in there. You know, for a little while they were kind of trying to figure out who's going to take this role on. Who wants to be the leadoff guy? What do you think about Parker Nolan?
Well, I mean, right now he's hitting 360 in league play. So, I mean, I'm not sure that Cole Messina will be batting second for you as the year ends. I don't think it's been as great for him. He's hitting 174 in league play, and you know, he's 266 now, but Cole's such a team player, he's taking that role on. I think when the magic eight ball, you shake it and it's all done, I think it'll be him in that probably 4 or 5 spot, Ethan Petry maybe in 3 or maybe 4, Kennedy Jones in 3, but Parker Nolan right now, you can't move him. I mean, on-base percentage in the league is .429. Last night, the leadoff home run on night where it wasn't just howling out to left field, that ball was hit hard. and lead off with a home run. He just looks very, very comfortable. He still, I think, leads the league in position players and actual games played. So, I mean, he's that old of a veteran guy that right now, boy, it's working. I wanted a left-handed hitter in that two-hole. I love it when a lefty's hitting, you know, runner on and you can do things, but I wouldn't move a thing right now for sure. Now, if somebody, if say Kennedy Jones can't go, I think you got to start tinkering around a little bit again. But right now I would just write the same lineup I've been writing. Obviously not the one last night because they just let a few guys jump in, but conference play, I'd just keep writing the same one right now.
Yeah. Well, I don't know, man. Dalton Reeves woke up today, probably knocked on King's door asking, hey, do you mind? I know that's his former team, but you lost them in the TV lights, but those balls went a long way, didn't they? They left the yard in a hurry.
We think the first one went out of the stadium.
Mm-hmm.
We were trying to catch on camera. I mean, they were crushed. And I don't know if you could write a script for a guy to get to play his old team, Carolina fan, here for his last year, and you hit two home runs. It was funny to me as he did the little post game that we do. He still had the mask on top of his head. I watched him walk over to the PC dugout. He still had all his gear on. And what that tells you, and I've been there, I don't want to take this stuff off because as soon as I take this off and go shower, my dream may be over. And I don't mean not play again, but you know what I mean. This is that his parents were on the field after a game taking pictures, you know, with him and his teammates. It's just one of those moments as a parent and as a player, you didn't want that one to end. You just wanted to get on the bus and, you know, wear your uniform with the gear still on. And that was so cool to watch him do that.
He's got that high leg kick. Who's that remind you of?
Say that again now.
His leg kick, when he steps in the box, he's kind of got that high leg kick to get ready. That
in your boy?
Do what? No. I don't know. I kept trying to think. I felt like I knew who it reminded me of, but I can't figure it out. There's somebody with a big leg kick, and I can't think of who it is. I was hoping you would say it, and that would jog my memory. But whenever I do, I'll text you.
Yeah, I'll think too on it. I'll be honest, I was just caught off guard because I hadn't really seen him hit that much.
No. Yeah. I mean,
caught me off guard.
Yeah, let's see. He's got 5 ABs on the year, and he's got about 950 feet worth of home runs.
Yeah.
I mean, and he's only hit 2 of them. That's something.
Thank goodness he did, too. I didn't think we were going to need all those runs the way it started. I thought we'd just cruise on out of there with a 10-run rule, and all of a sudden, you know, Chris Veach found in a 5-run game. So it was nuts.
Hey, Cat Daddy here in the chat box. Now, two different sizes here, but he said Carlos Cortez. Not a bad one. All right. Couple others. Ask you about Alabama. We'll get you out of here. So Blake Jackson's been swinging it well too. Honestly, his stats don't really do him justice because I think in the Vandy series, he hit 3 or 4 on the nose and they were just kind of right at guys. What have you been seeing out of this young man?
Yeah, he's been a tough luck guy. Overall, he's got 291. You look on a stat sheet and you're at 291, you feel good. It's the conference play that's kind of where his hard luck, he's hitting 214. But he has been the guy where some guys have been every ball to fall. His guys make incredible plays, or the guy's positioned exactly where to be, or he hits the pitcher in the foot like the ball the other day. I mean, you can't hit a ball any harder up the middle, and it perfectly goes to a third baseman who throws home for a tag play. So I'm telling you, I liked that outfield last week. Kennedy Jones is healthy. I'm running that same lineup I ran against Vanderbilt out there, and I'm letting Ethan Petrick DH. And I'm seeing how I go because, the Alabama team, they're leading the league in overall batting average. They're hitting 324, but they're only hitting 278 in league. Because now we're getting enough numbers where I kind of crumble up your overall stats and throw them to the side. Because I don't know who you've played. I don't know who I played. But I know at the conference, we're all playing basically the same people. So I start looking at those stats, and that's what jumps out to me. Is when you really get into the conference stats. This Alabama team, they beat Tennessee 2 out of 3. Tennessee's really good. There ain't no doubt about that. They beat them in Tuscaloosa. Then they go to Georgia and lose 3 games to a team that we thought was good who went to Kentucky and lost. So maybe Kentucky's good. So you just start going, why don't we just realize it's a normal SEC season?
Yep.
Each weekend is kind of a, you know, a show of its own. Last weekend against Vanderbilt, I don't think South Carolina really could have played much better. And I don't know if I've ever seen Vanderbilt play as poorly. Mm-hmm. But you get out of there, not only with a series win, but one extra win kind of in the bank for you. Because now you got that third win on a weekend that you can keep for when you run into one of them weekends, which you're going to, where everything goes well for the other team. And you're going, boy, we must have had a black cat run in front of the bus on the way here. Because those come in this league. What you want to do now is what we've talked about. You set yourself up. If you can just keep taking care of business every week, then you're, you know, in that spot to really contend at the end of the year. But the whole thing about this is the host. The whole time you're thinking host. How do we host? You don't screw around with midweek games or non-conference. We haven't. And you take care of business. If you get 16, 17 wins in the conference and have taken care of your other business, you're hosting.
Yeah, the Florida Gators are having some trouble doing that right now. But then they get an SEC play and they just turn right back into the Florida Gators. Gamecocks have a trip down there coming up soon. But Dylan Brewer, final player I want to ask you about here, only hitting 217 in conference play. But if you look past that, 4 of 10 versus Vandy this past weekend, I remember when they moved him into the leadoff spot, and don't mean this, Coach King or Monty, any of you guys, if you're watching, you know me, I'm not second-guessing anything, but retracing my steps as a hitter, some guys are just comfortable in certain spots in the order. And I thought to myself when he moved up, man, I wonder how he'll take this. You know, will he embrace that and really be what they're looking for? But boy, when he hits sixth or seventh, I guess, in the lineup, he really seems to enjoy that role. And so what are your thoughts on him and what he can provide and kind of wrapping this lineup around back to the leadoff guy?
Yeah, well, no doubt. He's got 10 stolen bases. Here's two. I'm going to kind of link another guy in with him. When he and Will Tippett get on base, Tippett's 12 for 12 on stolen bases. I joked with Derek last night. When you steal two bases and your pants are cleaner than the pitcher, then you get good jumps. He never slid last night. Mm-hmm. He just was timing so well. But those two guys, we got 36 stolen bases as a team, which puts us at like seventh or eighth, which I love. They got 22 of them. So Dylan Brewer and Will Tippett offensively, I would tell them to never look at the scoreboard when your stats are up there. All I want you is on base. Because when they're on base and they're having to pitch to the likes of Kennedy Jones and Ethan Petrie and Cole Messina with them on base, this offense is really pretty good. When they're not on base, you can tell it's kind of a different offense in a sense that the pitcher's coming from the windup or he's not worried so much about making a perfect pitch. I'll just walk, Ethan. So we need those two to get it clicking and not to where they're jumping up. Dylan Brewer's second in team in batting average. He's hitting 346, but he's hitting like 500. So, I mean, he's fallen 150 points. So you go, oh, my God, he's still got everything right in front of him. He's got 28 hits. But he quit bunting. He kind of took that away from himself because I asked. Nobody told him to quit doing that. If you remember, I mean, he was bunting 1-2 times a game.
Yeah.
And he kind of went away from that a little bit. I think he saw a little power. Remember, he hit some home runs, and that does it to all of us. And then, you know, Will Tippett, he's playing shortstop. You talk about a guy you don't want going down. That's the guy. That guy's playing shortstop really well right now. He's turning double plays. We're leading the league in double plays.
Yeah.
And y'all listen to me at all. You know how I feel about double plays. They're the turnovers of baseball. When you talk about defense as leading the league in turnovers, we all go, that's the best defense in the league. When you're leading the league in double plays, you should be considered one of the best defenses in the league because those are game-changing plays. The play last week against Vanderbilt changed the whole series. It's 3-1 game. Vanderbilt is about to start running, and we turn one of the best double plays of the season, come in, score runs, and Vanderbilt is done. So – That's kind of where I go with those two. But, yeah, Brewer's kind of settling back, I guess, in that seven spot. You got Tippett nine. If those two guys could get on base, you know, this weekend at a big clip, we'll be talking about a really successful weekend next week when we talk.
It's another top 20 matchup for the Gamecocks and another top 20 matchup for the Southeastern Conference. Wow. It's every weekend these things are going on all over the place. We'll find out today, I would imagine, at some point in time, Kingston will announce the starting rotation. For those wondering why that may be a conversation, they played the double dip Saturday, and now you're playing Thursday, so you're moving Eli Jones up an entire day, entire 2 days, if you start him tomorrow night. But he only what did he throw? 70 what pitches last week?
I think 77.
I mean, that's not bad.
I was weight room Saturday, Sunday morning. I get confused. Eli Jones had already started his "I need to throw on Thursday" propaganda.
Okay,
if he ain't throwing Thursday, I'm shocked. Okay. I really am. He was in the weight room. He was telling everybody that would stop. You didn't even really have – you could walk by. He was saying, "Hey, I feel great today. I'll be able to go Thursday." But Eli said something to me is why he would start if I were the head coach. He said, "Coach, I feel I want to set the tone every week for our pitching staff." Mm-hmm. Because I want to show them you don't have to throw 95 to win this league. You got to compete and throw strikes. And I want every weekend to start with that mindset. And he said that to me, and that's one of the most mature responses you can ask for a college pitcher.
Well, you got that right. And another just tremendous kid. He's a tremendous kid. Wow. Yeah. If you have a son, you want him to act like Eli Jones. We got to know him a little bit. What a dude. He reminds me a little bit of Mike Sisko, but he's got better hair. And I like him better than Mike. Mike's, you know, guy makes a great ham, but he's outside of that.
He hadn't brought me a nice ham sandwich yet, so I'm going to leave my answer out on Sisko.
good luck. You know, I go in there, I'm like, "Is Mike here?" "Oh, he's busy." I'm like, "You tell him his best friend is here."
Yeah.
He can't come out right now. I'm like, "Okay, well, I'll just go back there and make my own sandwich the way that I want it." since he
can't. I gotta give you one Justin Smoke story. So right. Week Kate Crenshaw is a bobblehead collector. And he brought to me to keep in the press box a Justin Smoke bobblehead that he bought online for me. So I text Justin, said, "Hey, finally got you in the booth." And we text some. So as game two starts, Justin texts me and goes, "Oh, I guess your contract, you only work one game." And it's like the third end of the game two. So I text back, "So what are you talking about?" He goes, "Well, I'm watching the game and you're not doing it this game." I said, "Justin, I do the radio."
Oh no. Oh,
we lost your audio. Can you hear us? No. Oh no.
No. Always right when it gets good.
Well, I don't know. Can you hear us? We lost your audio. We can't hear you.
Yeah.
Must have been the university Wi-Fi.
I bet it blinked.
Can you hear us? Can you hear us? He can't hear us.
I don't think so.
Mm-mm. Yeah. All right. See ya. Coach Lake go on that. But that sounds about right. Yeah. Yeah. That's to a T.
Not doing this game.
he Justin doesn't even know what I do. And he's been on my show.
That's right.
Multiple times for 10 years.
Like, he thinks, I think he works in radio. I'm like, Justin, man.
No. Close.
All right. I got to get out of here. Matt Anderson up next. Derek Scott here at 140. Schubert's back, or Paul Blart. Either way, it's all good. He had to. He got caught in traffic this morning, so
we've got
him now. Yeah, that's Lake Charleston, South Carolina. Wherever you go, traffic follows you, my man.
Except it's nice down there, and you live raining. With it.
It's right.
It's raining again. I mean, is South Carolina just going to float away? I mean, literally. I mean, I was there a week. It didn't rain. I mean, maybe I just need to come on back. So
It's Holy Week. It usually rains a couple, 3 days this week. It's weird how that works, but it does.
Yeah. It rains all the time here. It is what it is. Lolly. Right. Lollipop. Bobby Lollipop. There we go. All right.
Thanks, Bobby. We're very sorry.
Sorry about that, man. Thank you. Really appreciate that. All right, guys. Y'all enjoy the rest of the day. We'll be back tomorrow. Mike Morgan joins us tomorrow. John Strickland joins us tomorrow. Looking forward to that. And look forward to listening to y'all on the way to this appointment I got to get to. So.
Yeehaw, John Strickland. Yeah, look forward to seeing him.
Gamecock Traditions will keep you dressed. Electric Bikes of Charleston will keep you moving. JC and Phil will keep you entertained until 2 o'clock.
I'm so nervous. Oh, my God. We'll be right back.
I said, oh, Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barndo Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let a Big Ten stop. And originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of the heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring, and they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app, part of the Chief Sports Network.
That's right. Billy G's brings you the national anthem every day. Welcome back. Second hour of Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Back at you. Phil here. JC. Matt Anderson joins. JB will be back tomorrow. Got some other work to do. So I don't know where we want to kick things off here, gentlemen.
I'm going to kick it off. I'm going to kick it. I got a tasty groove, and I'm going to kick
right.
it.
That's right. Let's do it.
welcome back. Always like the patriotic thing. And for those of you that were watching, I didn't say much. I love the conversations between JB and Stuart.
Yeah.
And sometimes when I chime in, I feel like an idiot. And so I said my little thing about the cafe over in Northport. Because I was actually worried it was closed. Because I was like, one time I recommended a bar in Spartanburg to somebody, and that bar had been closed for about 5 years. And but I did see the hours and stuff, so I chimed in with that, but that's it. And and I swallowed my Coke the wrong way in the middle of the segment, so if it looked like I was about to keel over, that's why. But this is JC Sherbert. We got Mad Dog Mullinax, we got Matty Ice, the late night Gamecock, Matt Anderson here with us. We'll take you the rest of the way. Derek Scott coming up, hour number three. Gonna put a bow on basketball, talk a little bit about more about the baseball series starting tomorrow. It's Easter weekend, and usually that means Thursday, Friday, Saturday series in the Southeastern Conference and all that good stuff. So we're ready to roll. I want to start by saying I'm sorry. I was a little short with the audience yesterday. That includes you guys and the members of the Big Spur. Sometimes JC gets a little mood, and he doesn't want to hear it anymore. That happens less and less these days. I'd been grinding on that VIP room stuff, and then you have six smart aleck remarks. You know, I got up really early on two Tuesdays are brutal for me when we do JC and Morgan, because I get up and do an hour on Bill Gunner on 107.5, and then we go straight into JC and Morgan. I had to take my wife to work this week too, so keep in mind I got an hour carpool through Chicago traffic in between this. I get back, JC and Morgan was extra long. I had to go book a doctor's appointment, two of them, in between shows, and I was late getting back on the show. And that's a fiasco these days. I don't know how anybody gets healthcare done. I mean, you almost need a secretary to book. I mean, I need a sleep study, and I need to visit a surgeon about something. It was 30 minutes to book two appointments, and I already had referrals.
JC, I got a brilliant idea. You're a Disney guy. I'm a Disney guy. You know how there's all these websites that track and monitor when Disney dining reservations open up, and you can just get an instant notification to your phone? You need the same thing with doctor's offices. Anytime an appointment opens up, just send me a notification. I'll call. I'll book it. Like, just tell me.
But, I mean, just like the Disney fanatics, though, you'd have health fanatics and people who aren't really sick going for follow-ups, and then make me only got my arms falling off. You know, I can't get my arm reattached. Because this lady's going and checking up on her peanut allergy for the fifth time. Are you sure I'm okay, doctor? I'm just like Disney. You know, you have the people that live there now, the bloggers. They take up all the ride reservations, and they live there, and they go to the parks every single day.
Yeah.
And you're like, these people need to be shot because – not shot, but, you know, hypothetically, it's symbolically shot. Executed, banished from the kingdom, so to speak, because they're in the rides all day, you know, and then they beat you to it because they beat the system because they're freaking professionals.
Did you ever think we're gonna
like your 6-year old doesn't Disney get to do
riders?
Yeah,
nah, man, I've gotten so fat that I got a scooter last time because my mom got a scooter, and she's got terrible knees, and then her daughter, who's my niece, really, is her granddaughter, she's raising her, has some things where she had to get the mental health pass. So we rode we got the front of every ride, and I felt bad because I'm not handicapped, you know. I kept repeating that line from Ricky Bobby. Don't tell me I'm not paralyzed. I don't think anybody at Disney got that. They're like, you are a fat slob. Go have another sloppy Joe turkey leg, you idiot. But I got on every ride, and I didn't even have to use Genie last time. But that's going to be the last time I go until I lose about 100 pounds. So Pat Kelsey going to Louisville. John Edward breaks that through Field of 68. And I'm going to ask you about that in a second, Matt, because it was kind of looking like Richard Pitino. I mean, that name really started popping up. Maybe it was wishful thinking. I think with Pat Kelsey, they probably hired the best coach.
With that Louisville job, it was interesting because there's still some probation hanging over the Louisville program, and it was always going to be tough for them to get a big name there. But Pat Kelsey, you know, from his time in the Big South, what he's done at College of Charleston, getting them to the tournament again this year, he is exactly the type of coach that Louisville needs. They need a fiery coach. They need somebody that's going to put butts in seats. And look, I don't think that Pat was their number one choice, probably not their fifth choice. But when you have those kinds of probationary things that are clouding your program, to get a Pat Kelsey, and congratulations to Pat, that's a heck of a job to go from College of Charleston to Louisville. And it'll be interesting to see who College of Charleston goes after, because that's a really good gig. Chad Holberg talks about it all the time from the baseball side of things. But the basketball side of things, they have a beautiful arena. I don't know if you guys have been there, but it's a really nice arena. You're in the heart of Charleston, and they're going to be able to go get another up-and-comer. And just watch out for the College of Charleston job. You know, if I was a mid-major coach, it'd be one of my top five jobs on my list.
You think they'll go up-and-comer rather than, you know, like a Bobby Crimmins type?
You know, it's hard to say. I think that right now with the changing landscape of NIL, I think it's going to be difficult for, you know, an established coach that, you know, might just want to be, you know, cashing in retirement checks, coaching basketball. And I don't think College of Charleston will be happy with that type of hire. So I do think they're going to have to get somebody younger that knows the landscape.
Darren Horn.
Good luck. Good luck.
Mike Boynton was a guy that came to mind, but he doesn't seem like he's too into the NIL thing. You know, I'm just thinking about like people that have coached that we know. Oliver Purdell. Do you dig him? How old is he now? 72.
He's got to be in his 70s.
Yeah, boy. He was really good at DePaul, wasn't he?
You know who would crush it there? John Calipari, but I don't think that John wants to go there.
Calipari, you can call it now. Yeah, Calipari to Charleston.
No, there was a lot of stuff about Calipari to SMU that was floating around yesterday. And the way I understand it is it's a very similar situation to Tom Crean at Indiana, where, you know, he won a Big Ten championship when his head was on the chopping block. And it's just a matter of time with Cal and Kentucky. I don't think they wanted to pay the $33 million buyout. Cal wanted every penny of it. I wouldn't be surprised if Calipari is out of Kentucky as soon as next season, at the end of next year. He's got a big rebuilding job, and that's crazy to say at Kentucky, but he's going to have to be very active in the transfer portal. He only has, I think, three top 25 guys coming in, which, you know, only three, but at the same time.
I don't know. I mean, he can put together the right. He's a good enough coach, I think, sometimes. Maybe it's better for him to do it this way. I don't know.
I agree.
It seems to be the way you get things done these days. But, yeah, Pat Kelsey's going to be a heck of a hire for Louisville. Here's my answer to Louisville being on probation. I don't care. I think it's a top 5 to 10 job. There's only so many basketball schools in the country that have put the resources behind the sport like Louisville does. They're kind of the Auburn of the state of Kentucky. Probably a little bit better than Auburn football historically. I know Auburn's had its moments just like Louisville, but just because Alabama's in that state, Auburn, they don't consider themselves second fiddle, even though they are, and Louisville certainly does not either. I remember those days back in the Metro Conference with Louisville and Memphis were like the two big dogs for South Carolina to have to face, and certainly I think he'll do a really good job there. I've always thought a lot of him as a head coach, and just curious to see who ends up getting the guy from App State. Would you go App State to Charleston? I don't know. You know, there's just a lot to consider.
Anyway, some assistant coaches at the Power 5 level get a sniff there too. I would encourage everybody to go to hoopdirt.com. If you guys don't go to HoopDirt, it's a really good website that covers everything from D3 coaching changes all the way up to Power 5 jobs. It's a really good website. I'm sure he'll have some names here soon. Unfortunately, College of Charleston is not on the 24/7 sports platform where you're going to have a hot list that comes out immediately. But there will be some stuff on HoopDirt if you're a Cougars fan.
There's no hot list for the College of Charleston. It's just not good.
JC, that's a market, man.
Is there not a Cougs 24/7? Like, come on.
I think it is. I think it's either Washington State or Houston.
Right. Well, right. Yeah.
CharlestonCougs.com, baby. Yeah, woo! I'd start Coastal before that. Coastal's got a little bit bigger fan base, and they've got football too. But, man, I'm not going to say the
username here, but there's a funny comment in the chat box. I love Cougars. Don't we all? Don't we all?
I'm married to one. You know, I guess if you're 2 years older or more, that's a cougar. Wow. Speaking of you, Phil, happy birthday to Dina, by the way.
I texted her today.
Yeehaw!
That's right.
There you go, Dina.
An older woman there. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, there you go. Rope them in.
So, yeah, but tying up the Gamecock season, you know, it's tough.
Hang on. We're not going there yet. I'm directing traffic. Hold on. I had some chat box things I needed to get to because while they're having their conversation, I sit there and notice them and make notes. Gamecock fan, Robbie Ashford's not playing baseball. And I'm going to say this generally. Every time you hear of a football player playing baseball, don't worry about it until it actually happens. A lot of times these guys will talk about it. A lot of times they're promised an opportunity. Most of the time they don't make the team, just to be straight up honest. South Carolina baseball is kind of at a different level. You know, you don't just walk in and they don't just put the football guy on the team. I mean, unless it's something like a Brandon McIlwain situation. So, and he was asked about possibly playing baseball because I think the media always will ask that. And he's, oh, sure, whatever. But he's focused on playing quarterback in South Carolina. I mean, he's probably a little too old to be chasing baseball. If he's going to play baseball, he probably needed to just go someplace and play baseball. But certainly was a very good player coming out of high school. In that sport, so yeah, just don't worry about that. And I would put that beside every football player that mentions they're going to play baseball or basketball player. Just put a little asterisk because we've heard of about about 127 football guys are going to play baseball. They never do, or they get cut, or they're not very good. So just keep that in mind. Moving forward, Jan asked if I lost my voice. No, I didn't. Almost did. Isaiah chimes in. Good to hear from you, Isaiah. We hadn't heard from you in a while. What have you heard about Judge Collier? Right now, he's the starting corner opposite O'Donnell Fortune. There is going to be a battle there. I don't know that O'Donnell Fortune, I would project him to be the starter, but I wouldn't pencil him in. You've got Vakari Swain. You got Emory Floyd. Beamer said yesterday that David Spaulding's playing on corner, which I kind of like. So we'll see what happens there. Somebody said something about the Marshall Tucker band. The bar in Spartanburg, the Marshall Tucker band used to frequent. Yeah, that wasn't Magnolia Street Pub, though. Magnolia's was kind of in my era. Phil, would the Marshall Tucker band have played at the New Way? Probably New Way's a little too small for them.
Yeah, I was thinking that might be a bit small. I don't know where the
Clancy's? Well, God, you don't remember Clancy's.
No, I don't
remember. It was awful. Clancy's, boy. I don't know where the market. I'd have to ask somebody like in my dad and mom's generation about that. So there you go for that. But yeah, I think that it's going to be interesting to see, you know, who comes out with that other cornerback job. But right now, to your question, it is Judge Collier. And if that happens, guys, I know Judge was not rated as high as Floyd and Swain, but that's just another South Carolina defensive back that's underrated as you know what that's going to start. I thought he played really, really solid for a true freshman last year when he was on the field. I mean, he wasn't perfect. Nobody was. But if they were giving up long touchdown plays, it wasn't – most of the 98% of the time it was not Judge Collier making a mistake. So we'll see. That was there anything to Corey Rucker visiting or was he just hanging out? If you got that on his social media, I don't address things like that. But I would be surprised considering the dude came and went and came and went. But you never know. I probably wouldn't take him. I probably think I'd get better. But we'll see what happens. Jan said there was a shootout there one weekend. Welcome to Spartanburg. Yeah. So anyway, that's now that we're all caught up on the chat box, and I haven't had a chance to talk about the Meechie Johnson thing too much. or the portal in general. And of course, Ibrahim Diba also hit the portal yesterday in football. Kelton Henderson didn't necessarily hit the portal. He's off the team. He's not on the team anymore. I don't know where he went. I'll say this about Henderson before we get to hoops. That's a guy that when we had Taylor Edwards on after they signed, Taylor said a lot of good things about him, said he did well in Under Armour, and he did. And then you didn't hear much about him. He's a ghost. Heard he was banged up at one point last year, just injured. Shows back up on the roster this spring at 6'1", 176, which I thought was bigger. So you're like, hey, well, maybe, you know, and then boom, he's just gone. So Kelton, I'm going to start calling him the ghost of Lehigh Acres, Florida. Just didn't know much about him. The kid didn't do a single interview when he was being recruited. No. I mean, you just didn't know much about the guy. He was here and he was gone. Here today, gone tomorrow. So best of luck, Kelton Henderson. We'll probably all be sitting around one day watching a team like Memphis or somebody like that on a Wednesday night game. And it's like, Kelton Henderson, oh my God. 8 catches, 167 yards, 2 touchdowns, and we all remember this conversation.
Yeah, and the Big Sur will blow up.
But it says our Florida recruiting has been pretty bad lately. I'd like to see him do a little more in certain parts of Florida, but I think that also if you look historically, Clint, they get a handful from down there that are good, and that's fine. I don't really think that we all need to sit here and complain about struggles in Florida and North Carolina when they're doing what they're doing in D.C. and Maryland, because you can get good players all over the place. Where I think criticism should come, rightfully so, is when you miss players in the state and you let them get out. You know, that's when you kind of got to sound the alarm. I would, though, to your point, I'd like to see him get in, you know, Tampa, South Florida, those areas. There's good football players down there. South Carolina's got a good name in most of those parts. I would like to see him do that. But, you know, Bruce Ellen, John says, Bruce Ellen is the only successful two-star I can recall in recent memory. He actually wasn't a two-star, he's a zero-star. He was basketball recruit, 4-star basketball recruit. I would say that, you know, Hunter Renfro. Are we talking just South Carolina? Pat DeMarco and Brandon Wiles were both 2-star prospects. So there you go. These days, I'd take a 2-star that other schools want over a 3-star because nobody likes to give 2-stars out. They give them to FBS or FCS and Group of Five guys mostly. So you know if a 2-star has some Power Five offers, there's some folks that know what they're doing that like him. Auburn took a kid like that a couple years ago. A kid ended up being all SEC. So, you know, these days, if you see 2-star, I'd get excited because the rankers that be just hand out 3-stars like Halloween at Halloween candy corn at Halloween. So, anyway, that's the deal there. All right. So, yeah, Brandon McIlwain starting out the season with the Mets AAA affiliate, saith Jan. Good for him. I hope his mother's happy and has found peace somewhere and isn't getting on people's Facebook like she got on mine and accusing me of bias. Like I engineered the entire Jake Bentley taking over thing. And like Jake was just and that Jake Bentley was just terrible and her son was so much better. And there was racism involved. That was the biggest clown show I've ever experienced in my life from a parent. You know, that was a pile of crap. I wanted Jake to start because Jake was the best option, and Jake ended up winning, 4 of 7 games and playing pretty well that year. And her son can throw it out. Then her son gets kicked off the team because he's not trying and doing not handling his business. And both coaching staffs are not real high on him, not as a player necessarily, but now he's handling his business. So, yeah, I could have thrown a lot more crap in that situation. I didn't appreciate that at all. But I hope – now that we're up, we're about 8 years, 9 years down the road from that. I do pray and hope the best for the McIlwain family. Willie says Brandon did get screwed. Please explain this to me. That's the least how he was handed the starting quarterback job as a freshman, could not get it done, benched, was not handling his business off the field. Is this another Ryan Helinski thing? Or are we going to sit here and talk about how he was actually the best? How Jake was not that good that year? How did he get screwed? He didn't screwed in baseball. He wasn't trying in that sport either. You know? I mean, I don't – I think that's the big – and then what she brought into it was a huge – I should have really called a lawyer. That's how bad that was. I mean, you want to get me fired up about it. Start besmirching my name and throwing that kind of stuff in there. Mm-hmm. I don't play that at all. So that's just with no starters at wide receiver. Now, Debo Samuel was out there. Brian Edwards is out there the whole time. Hayden Hurst was out there the whole time. Who did they get back? Debo got healthier. I'll give you that. He had Rico Dowdle. I don't know. I think that's Willie. I think it's the biggest lie ever that he didn't. He somehow didn't have a chance. A blind person could see Jake Bentley could throw the ball better than Brandon McElwain. A blind person. So I don't know what, and he couldn't run either. So I don't know what you're seeing. I was in a good mood too. But his mother was wrong in saying what she did and accusing any of the coaches or anybody of any kind of favoritism. That was a pile of bullshit. Okay. That's it. If you say that that's not true, you're lying. Okay. You're a liar. All right. You don't sit there and criticize people's name and their reputation, when it's clear that one thing is factual based on lies. All right, that's the bottom line of that situation. I'm not going to say anything else about it because I don't want to get off track. But they were totally in the wrong, and the coaching staff and myself that were all totally in the right. There's no middle ground. There's no debate. You are lying to yourself and everyone else or completely biased. You know, you got some sort of bias if you think otherwise. Nobody got screwed in that situation. Brandon McElwain screwed himself, if anything. Bottom line. Mm-hmm. I can't even handle that. Bentley takes over, all starters are playing and allowed to throw it downfield. Brandon threw bubble screens every play. That's not true. That's not true. Brandon couldn't throw it down the field. Did you not watch the games? You're lying. Or you're just mistaken. I don't want to call you a liar about that, but you're just mistaken. Kurt Roper was calling the offense, dude. Nobody was really given a great chance to go out there and sling it all over the field. But, I mean, I can't stand that because I got attacked personally over it. And so when you reinforce that lie, I'm going to come back at you. And it's a freaking lie. I hate to bring things up from 8 years ago. But it is a lie. It is a lie. You are a liar if you say that. A liar. And I don't appreciate it. All right. You want me to take a break?
Yeah, well, let's get a break on that note. After we've handled the situation with McElwain. I don't know. It's so interesting. That happened so long ago.
Yeah, and look, man, if his mom hadn't jumped all over my Facebook page and started accusing me of racism. And bias and accusing Bobby Bentley, who I've known my whole life. I mean, just because I've known the guy, it's like, oh, you're like I could tell Will Muschamp who to start. Because guess what? If I could have told Will Muschamp who to start, your sorry ass kid wouldn't even been on the field. Okay? Knowing what I knew then and now, which was beyond the fact that he was not good in the games. All right, well beyond that. All right, so, and again, I'm glad he's at AAA. Let's go make the majors. It's not the White Sox or Braves organization, is it?
No, I don't know.
It's the Mets.
Oh, good. I hate the Mets anyway.
Yeah, I'm not big on that.
I hate the Mets anyway. So, anyway, not the Braves. Although, this is not the Braves or the White Sox. But, yeah, I do sound a little like that out the other Alex Jones because my votes it's all scratchy. But, Willie, you know, I didn't mean to go off on you or anything like that. That just gets on me. You can understand where I'm coming from, man. You're a good listener, and I wasn't trying to go off on you personally. But you know, I got attacked by that, and I'm just, I'd forgotten about it. Now I'm remembering it, and it just pisses me off. All right, let's go to break.
All right.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com, a tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me. I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you're gone.
I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm a lover wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Mike here for one of the better dining options in the capital city. You know, when I first moved there, I asked people around the radio station, where are the best wings? Well, the consensus was D's Wings. That was then. Today, they still have the best wings, but it's so much more now in their new location at 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia. Yeah, they get voted the best wings on a routine basis. Yes, they get voted the best sports bar on a routine basis, but they're not just about wings, and really, they're not just a sports bar. It is a family-run local restaurant and bar with 20 TVs and 25 beers on tap. And how about these daily specials? Every Monday night at D's, you've got 75-cent wings from 4 until closing. Tacos on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, 18 wings and a pitcher of beer for $29. You've also got ribs and oyster bucket specials on Thursday. And no matter how big the party is, 20 or more, no problem. Just call ahead of time and they'll take terrific care of you. They'll do takeout as well. And guess what? A human will answer the phone and take the order. Billy and his staff do an outstanding job. Check out D's. 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia.
This is Jacoby Wright from Gamecock Basketball, and you are listening to the show with JB, Phil, and JC. Go Gamecocks!
Homer than you are. Welcome back, everybody, inside the Gamecocks, the show. Here we are live now. We've got Matt Anderson in with us for the next, well, for the duration of the show, 2 hours.
Today. Yes, thank God, because I just ate up about 30 minutes talking about ancient history. So
Derek Scott joins us about 1:40 today to talk a little baseball. I don't know if we've even talked to Derek since tournament appearance, so we'll get his thoughts on kind of the close of the basketball season as well. But any concern, guys, with Michi and Deba leaving, do we think? Is that an indication of something going on inside basketball program? Or I know it's suspected he's getting closer to home, at least on Michi's end, right?
Well, with Michi, what I was told was surprised it happened like this, but not shocked that it happened.
Right.
And if he goes home, that wasn't Red Craig. Red's a little dog.
I think that was my dog Landis.
Some hound somewhere. But I think it stinks a little bit because it stinks for Carolina. Sucks for Carolina because he was a really good player for 2 years, the leading returning scorer. I thought he played very unselfishly this year and within the system for the most part. Played kind of within himself, and that's going to be the key moving forward is to find guys that can do that. So it's kind of hard to, like, you can go get a guy with a skill set like that, but is he going to come in and when he's not on, drive and dish like Michi, share the ball like Michi? Michi had a lot of plays where he set guys up and really made nice, you know, assists and things of that nature. That's the unfortunate part of it. Can he be replaced? Certainly. If he ends up going home, look, his dad's a high school coach up there. They had a hard time getting to the games. That's a lot of travel. Trust me. I live in the Midwest and have to come to Columbia frequently. It's not easy to fly into Columbia. There's not like a list of flights, especially from Ohio. I mean, I live in Chicago, guys, and then there's more flights direct to Columbia than, you know, New York, D.C., Chicago, and that's about it, you know. So it's hard to get there. And so if you want to go home and play for Ohio State or whoever and be close to your family, who am I to say, you know, bye? You know, who am I to have hard feelings about it? I think from a roster standpoint, it just kind of largely depends on, you know, how do they fill it. With Deba, you know, I think – he started getting minutes towards the end there because I think he decided he wanted to go give it a go. And I think he realized probably that if he goes back down a level, he can probably play. Like if he went to upstate Matt or someplace like that, he'd have a chance to get back on the court. I'd love
to see him in a school like Charleston Southern.
Yeah. It's South Carolina in the SEC right now. I don't know that's realistic, but, you know, Eli Ellis is coming in the next year, guys, unless he reclassifies for some reason, which is not – I don't think it's happening according to what Whittle's been reporting, but it's not totally off the table, if that makes any sense. And now if he comes in, boy, that's you're talking about somebody that can fill it up from 35 feet. Jeez. Y'all are going to love him. Yeah. If you like shooting, you're going to like that guy. But so that's the deal there. And Matt, I know you and I were, and I know you probably addressed it on late night last night, but just go ahead and give this audience kind of your take on it. I know you text me and shared some thoughts after you got in the portal and just kind of take our audience to where they need to go with this.
Yeah. I mean, I think the starting point there is I don't know what's considered tampering anymore, but there were rumors about 3 or 4 weeks ago that Ohio State was going to make a run at Michi Johnson. You know, I thought all that kind of was, you know, done when Lamont Paris decided to stick around at South Carolina. And look, he had an offer from Ohio State. He chose to stay at South Carolina. And I thought that was probably going to clinch it with Michi. As far as I know, JC, and you're probably closer to this as well, this was not necessarily expected. This was something where, you know, Michi probably got an offer that he felt like he couldn't refuse. All indications are he's going back to Ohio State. Ohio State just named John Diebler, their head coach. He had the interim tag there for a little bit. He was an assistant coach at Ohio State for a long time, probably has a decent relationship with Michi Johnson. And I think that's probably where that's going to go. But as far as replacing Michi Johnson, Michi could fill it up. And when he did, he was electric. He was one of the most fun basketball players in the country to watch. And I've said this since the preseason. At different points, it looked like the rim was 8 feet in diameter when Michi was shooting from all over the court. He could just fill it up in a hurry. And when he got hot, it was awesome. But from a consistency standpoint, from, you know, just a points per game standpoint, JC brought up a good point about the assist numbers. I think those assist numbers will come from whoever fills that role based on Lamont Paris's system and the way that he schemes people open and the way they share the basketball. I think you can find a Michi Johnson level contributor on the transfer portal. And I think I caused a stir the other day on the Big Spur unintentionally when, you know, the Michi news broke and I said, look, you know, Colin Murray Boyles, Zach Davis, Josh Gray, you know, Miles Studi, Jacoby Wright, all these kids have somebody in their ear right now. Now, whether they're listening to them, I don't know. But I'd know for a fact that mid-major schools are losing kids at a rapid level right now to Power 5 schools. And the numbers that have been floating around to me have been 100,000, 150,000, 50,000. How much of that is true? Who knows? These numbers are, they're always out there. And it's not as out there as they are in football when you hear about high school senior quarterbacks getting $7 million to come play football at whatever school. But there are options for these kids if they decide they don't want to be at South Carolina. I don't foresee that happening. You know, in my mind, the two that you worry about the most are Colin Murray Boyles and Zach Davis. I think they have both have ridiculously bright futures at South Carolina. But there are going to be 200 to 300 players in the portal that South Carolina just needs to go find five of them. That's all it is. And the way that basketball is played now, so many of these kids play AAU and they're on one team one weekend and the next weekend they're on a different team. I don't really have a worry about schematically playing together. They'll figure all that out. They have an entire summer. They have an entire preseason. They have exhibition games, practice. I'm not worried about them figuring that out. And I don't think Lamont Paris is going to bring in a guy that's not going to buy into his role in his system and, you know, what he's going to be at South Carolina. So it's interesting. I mean, you're going to see names flying off the rails right now. Like Sean Padula just went into the portal from Virginia Tech. We all remember Sean Padula against South Carolina earlier this year. Phenomenal player. There's a number of them from the West Coast Conference at Pepperdine that are in the portal. Colorado's losing. Everybody's losing players. There's going to be ample opportunity for the Gamecocks to restock their roster and make another NCAA tournament.
Yeah, and there's like the 150 number. I don't get into like individual what they're getting paid, right? I can't. I mean, not that I can't, or I just don't, and I'm never going to. I mean, unless there's some kind of disclosure, because a lot of it's strategic. You know, you don't want, you know, school A doesn't want school B to think that they, you know, to know what they're paying, because then you can just easily top it and move forward. And there's finite resources at every school right now. But 150 is not for a good player. That's not egregious. Not in college basketball. Really not in football at certain positions either. I mean, that's really not that bad. Sounds weird because I had to work a long time in my life to make that salary. You know, and I can't imagine if I'd have gotten it in college. I worked at Sammy's Deli in college. I made $5 an hour cash under the table. If any of you work for the IRS out there, please don't go bust Sammy's Deli for that. That was, I shouldn't have said that, but, you know, I do think knowing what I know about Colin Murray Boyles and his kind of NIL situation, I think South Carolina's going to be fine there. I don't see Zach hopping kind of based on what he got NIL-wise this year versus what kind of the plan is moving forward. And in all these situations, never say never, right? Because just never say never. I mean, I thought
that was more my point on the Big Spur.
Everybody's getting
– this is the world we're living in.
Yeah, everybody's coming back. Yeah, I mean, everybody's either coming back or leaving. I mean, you can't write anything off or count anything out when it comes to the subject. But, you know, and I thought, you know, with what I kind of knew about Michi's situation and like, again, the NIL this year versus moving forward, because that situation's improved. Thanks to all of you, by the way, who have joined the $1,000 club on Garnet Trust. That's big time. And there's several of you that have done that. And just for me mentioning it here, thank you so much, because that helps Garnet Trust. It helps me further believe in what I'm doing with the new group. And you guys are awesome. But and there'll be a smaller dollar basketball initiative, too, to help with NIL soon, I believe. So you know, because a thousand's really not, I mean, it's not cheap, you know. But anyway, I think that the situation there has improved just like other sports here in South Carolina is no longer bottom of the barrel. They're not toward the top. They're not Ole Miss yet, which is what I think everybody should strive to get to. So these guys are going to be obviously making more to come back. And you know, with Michi, I'm not sure that it was – I'm not sure that when you consider his value, Matt, that he's going to get necessarily more money. I mean, he may save more money because he's closer to home. But I don't know about more money. And I know we got to get to a break, though.
No, you're good. Yeah, no worries.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to take a break and come back. And I want to get your take, Matt, on this Trent Noah kid who basically lit up the Kentucky State Tournament.
Yeah.
Man, okay.
And yet, boy, garnered no offer from Kentucky themselves. How about that?
Cal probably. I mean, if this kid comes to South Carolina and the Gamecocks continue, keep in mind Lamont Paris is 2-0 against Kentucky and John Calipari. I know Darren Horn was 2-0 against Kentucky as well, but he was coaching against a guy that you know, was kind of peaked in Texas, and that was it. Not a guy that's won national championships and been to Final Fours and coached how many NBA players. So that's it's still a different Kentucky. So I want to get your take on Noah coming in and kind of some of the guys maybe out there. I know there's a kid from Furman they're kind of looking at guard, a kid from Michigan they're looking at. Just kind of give us your take as a basketball guy on some of the possible fits and opportunities out there to, you know, maybe not only – just replace Michi, but upgrade. I mean, I had kind of a thought the other day. If they can get a 6'6 guy that can shoot, that has length on the perimeter on defense, you get like he's a Zach Davis, but with ball skills. I know I'm describing like the perfect NBA shooting guard, but like a PJ Dozier type guy. I mean, that's an upgrade to me because, you know, Michi at the end of the day is 6'2". So we'll be back after this on Inside the Gamecocks Show. We are built by the Barndo Co. Served always by Chicken Cock Whiskey, cock-a-doodle-doo. And we'll be back. Matt Anderson, Mad Dog.
It's 2024, and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming on the Chief Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chief Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
Hey, Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington at the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium and the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arenas. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. Custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. rescuesandresin.com, and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
right, final segment of the second hour, Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Always much respect and our eternal gratitude to all of our military members. I know we've got a lot of you that listen. We appreciate each and every one of you. And, of course, we give you a big thank you for your service. So, Matt, looking at what we've got coming in and what we're kind of hearing about what might be in the works, I know Trent Noah seems to be kind of the biggest name of this incoming freshman class. What are your thoughts here? Is this a guy that can come in and is going to immediately start, or are we looking at, you know, it's going to need a little bit of time?
You know, he has the one thing that you can't teach, and I'm a firm believer by the time you get to this level of high school competition, this level of AAU, college, if you can't shoot, you're not going to ever be a consistent shooter. And we know that he can shoot in spades. You look at his form is beautiful. I mean, it's a picturesque shot from 35 feet all the way down to pull-ups on the elbow, pump fakes. When you look at his game, I think that his handle probably needs to tighten up a little bit. I don't know if he's the guy that you can kind of run an offense through, if that makes sense. I think he's more of a guy that's going to need to go shot hunt. And what I mean by that is run off screens, put yourself in a good position. And that's the case for any freshman that's coming into college basketball. There's only a handful of them, like the Rob Dillinghams of the world at Kentucky, the Kyrie Irvings at Duke, that can come in as freshmen and just get where they want on the court at any point in time. But on the flip side of that, he's 6'6". I'd be surprised if he's actually 6'6" by the time he comes to campus. I think he's probably more in that 6'4 to 6'5 range, just from a height perspective. But looking at him, you know, he's listed at 6'6", 200. He's got a good build. You know, he's got strength in his arms. He got strength in his legs, his thighs, you know, all of that. He looks like a basketball player. Kind of looks and look, everyone's going to do this forever for a white guy that comes out that's 6'6", 6'7", that's strong. They're going to say Dalton Connect. He's not Dalton. I don't think he's Dalton Connect as a freshman. But what I am going to say is, you know, he has a good build to him. I've seen him drive into the lane. I've seen him finish their contact. I've seen him make his free throws. And Bruin Nation, I don't know if he's going to shrink. I just think that he might be listed at 6'6" in high school. I mean, I was listed at 6'4", and at the time I was 6'1". So I think he's probably just listed a little taller than he is. And just looking at his highlights and kind of sizing up the other guys that he's playing against. There can't be that many 6'6" guys playing defense in Kentucky high school basketball. I'll put it that way. And some of those guys look about his height. But, no, I think he's definitely a guy that can contribute. I think that, you know, Morris Ugasuk had an opportunity to contribute this year when they put him in position. And they were trying to kind of build Morris up in a point guard role. And, you know, maybe Trent Noah can come in. I think that he'll be able to hit shots. He could probably be a 6 to 8 point-a-game scorer as a freshman, which is really neat. And I think he's going to be a really good player in time. I think, you know, we're talking about sophomore year, junior year. I think he's underrated right now as a recruit at like 131st in the country or something like that. I think he's clearly a top 100 guy in my estimation. Now, have I scouted all 5,000 high school players? No, but I've watched enough highlights. I think that he's going to be a really good player. I think that the biggest question mark for South Carolina going to next year is replacing Talon Cooper. It's not replacing Michi Johnson. It's not replacing BJ Mack. It's Talon Cooper. And look, Talon Cooper was kind of a later addition in the transfer portal window last year. Came from Minnesota. Before that was in Morehead State. 6'4", 215 pounds. You know, every bit of that, in my opinion. That's going to be just finding a guy that can initiate the offense, but also set the tone defensively. When the Gamecocks weren't in their 1-3-1 zone with Zach Davis at the head of that snake, Talon Cooper really set the tone by guarding some of the best point guards in the SEC, some of the best players on the opposing team. You're going to have to find a replacement for Talon. I think that, you know, Morris is going to have to bulk up significantly, but from a size standpoint, you know, 6'4", probably 6'5", he has the size and athleticism to do it. He's just got to get stronger. I think the Gamecocks have to find a portal point guard. And I'm not saying that needs to be a clone of Talon Cooper. There are a million point guards in the world that are efficient and can play at 5'9" or play at 6'7". So, I mean, and interesting enough, you know, I think you might see Zach Davis plays in point guard next year. He played point guard in high school. I think that he's kind of like a Trent Noah, where his handles weren't really there his freshman year or his sophomore year. But just that athleticism, the ability to have his length and see over the top of defenses, you might see him do that some next year. But the Gamecocks have got to find a replacement for Talon Cooper. JC, you know, you mentioned the Doug McDaniel kid from Michigan, and you have the JP Pegues guy from Furman. I know that those guys are, you know, according to Whittle's reporting, are guys that the Gamecocks have circled in on. There's a kid from Chattanooga that the Gamecocks are talking to. You know, looking through here, I mean, you can just pull up, you know, the top 100 transfer portal guys, and every site has a ranking for them. You know, I think outside of like, you know, the top 15, you're not really looking at guys that can elevate your program from, you know, it, getting into an NCAA tournament to a Sweet 16 type run. You're going to have to kind of make Frankenstein's monster, which is what Lamont Paris is really, really, really good at. If I could find anybody in the portal that I want, it's Kay Tyson from Belmont. 6'7", kid that can just shoot the crap out of a basketball, strong kid. I think he averaged about 5 rebounds a game, shot 50% from 3 on the season, averaged 17 points a game. He's a guy that I'd really like, but, you know, just, you know, when you look at these rankings, just know that, you know, Kay Tyson, I've heard, is North Carolina's to lose, and North Carolina has an offer. And I know Duke's going to be sniffing around that kid. There's a lot of kids here. I mean, with Gonzaga is still in the tournament. They already picked up the best player from Pepperdine in the transfer portal, a kid that averaged, you know, 17, 18 points a game. I think that, you know, just mining the portal, and, you know, it's almost a blessing in disguise for the Gamecocks not to be playing an NCAA tournament right now. We'd all prefer to be playing, don't get me wrong, but, you know, just monitoring these names and getting on guys early, having those first couple phone conversations, you know, building a relationship. Because, JC, you know, I think that the college basketball portal moves faster than the college football portal.
I mean, BJ Mack largely, I mean, he took a while and visited, but largely came to South Carolina because Lamont Paris immediately made him a priority. I mean, Lamont went to see him before the Gamecocks even played in the SEC tournament last year. And that was the biggest get. I mean, that was a guy they had to fight off some other teams for, BJ. Yeah. And BJ's a unique player. So everybody's looking for a guy, a stretch five, somebody like that. But, you know, as far as Trent and Noah goes, you know, my boy Chris of Nana Sports fame has watched him play a lot and talked to some people in Kentucky. They said the kid could be Rex Chapman. So that would be the high end. I think some other guys maybe to look at, Dane Bradshaw, who we had on the show, Travis Kraft, the North Dakota assassin, played here under Fogler, that's on the lower end, and Bryce Sheldon. Everybody got everybody got quiet.
Benulis as well.
We're not going Lithuanian here. We're just saying American shooting guards. But no, I mean it. Yeah, there's always a range for people. There's a ceiling and a floor, and just eyeballing it, it kind of seems like that. But I don't know. You guys know better than me. But we got to get out of here at the top of the hour.
Sam Decker's the comp that I like. Sam Decker played at Wisconsin under Lamont. You know, Sam was a little bit of a streaky shooter, not a great three-point shooter early in his career. Ended up getting to about 35, 36, 37%, but was just a shot maker, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can have great shooters, and sometimes you just have freaking shot makers. And Michi Johnson was a shot maker at different points in the season. Maybe not a great shooter per se, but a shot maker. He just went cold at the wrong time. The JP Pegues, I don't know how to pronounce his name.
It's a fearless dude.
Yeah, he's a shorter guy, kind of like a Devin Downey ish kind of.
He doesn't care. He could care less. He's fearless. That's a guy that obviously I think could actually be a lot like Michi Johnson if they got him. You know,
absolutely. You know, a little bit smaller, but you know, Michi wasn't a humongous guy. He was only 6'2".
Yeah,
The one guy I will tell you not to get your hopes up on is Tucker DeVries.
He was from Drake. His dad just got the head coaching job at West Virginia. All indications are that he is going to West Virginia with his dad after testing the NBA draft, testing his chops there. But that's a kid that, you know, you want a shot maker, you want the best player in the transfer portal. It's Tucker DeVries, in my opinion. But this stuff's going to keep growing. There are going to be players. I mean, you know, I reference Duke a lot because I do pay attention to Duke. But they're probably going to lose some guys to the portal. You know, South Carolina just needs to continue that defensive mindset. What's the kid's name in Duke right now? I'm not going to pull it up. Anyway, they have a guard. Actually, I'm going to pull it up. That I think would be right. Great in South Carolina.
Yeah. We can.
We'll do it on the other side.
Conversation on the other side here, Matt. So let's wrap things up. We're of course live from the Signarama Studios. JC Sherbert, Matt Anderson, Phil Mullinax in with you, and we will see you at the top of the hour.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cole Joel here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasporch.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand. 'Cause I got him for you. Take
All right. Welcome back, everybody. Final hour of Inside the Gamecocks, the show cranking up right here. Phil Mullinax, JC Sherbert, and of course, Matty Ice, Matt Anderson in with us. Talking a little basketball here. We continue the conversation there. So you think there's a potential Duke player on the roster that would be considering transfer, Matt? What was that before we hit it?
Yeah, it's Jalen Breaks. Martin got it in the chat box. Jalen Breaks is a former top 100 player, kind of got buried in the depth chart at Duke. Really easy to do at Duke right now. But top 100 player, you know, 6'2", kind of like a Michi Johnson story where hasn't shot the ball too well, might just need a fresh change of scenery, but tough as nails, great defender. You know, two seasons ago had back-to-back 17-point games against NC State and Florida State. He's a player that I think could be, you know, a good target for the Gamecocks. Now, he's from New Jersey. Does that mean that he wants to go back closer to home? You know, could Rutgers be in his future? I don't know. But, you know, Lamont Paris has had success with kids like that over his time. And, you know, he's practicing against great competition. He's got good player development, just probably buried. So he's a kid. The Cade Tyson kid I mentioned today, I forgot to tell you guys, he might not be a guy that the Gamecocks can get. His older brother is Hunter Tyson, who played at Clemson. So maybe not coming to South Carolina, but sometimes kids want to change things up. But there's going to be so much movement in this portal. So many guys that are going to get added. Coaches right now have to figure out how many players they can bring in, who's going to move on. So, you know, we can kind of tie a bow on the transfer portal stuff. You know, more names are going to emerge over time, and you can bury yourself getting hopeful and wishful about these types of things. John Whittle will have you covered on the Big Spur anytime he has a name that he feels comfortable putting out there. So,
yeah,
it's fun to dream. Roster dreaming, right?
I mean, there's a lot of South Carolina certainly is more attractive, I think, this offseason than last, based on two things: the success they had this year, and that gets people's attention. Plus, the NIL situation is better. They're not all the way home with it, but they are. Let's just say it's better than it was last year. A little more resources. I think everybody to be really competitive. It probably needs to double from here, but I think that compared to where it was, boy, you know, you're talking about putting something together with scotch tape and bubble gum and candy wrappers and stuff like that last off season. And hey, that got you a team that was a lock for the big dance, a top five finisher in the SEC, top really tied for second in the league, that set records and tied records. Had they had a different draw, maybe would have gotten this, could have gotten to the Sweet 16 with a favorable draw. Who knows? But if that's what that can get you, imagine what more can get.
I think you can still build off of what happened with GG Jackson. You know, didn't have the greatest season in South Carolina from a team or personal perspective, but you know, what he's able to do in the NBA and how he credits Lamont Paris for his personal growth, both on and off the court. He's a great ambassador for South Carolina right now.
But I'll say this in the sport of basketball, though. All that stuff can get you in the door, but the best closer in the country, his last name is Cash. And it's not, first name's not Johnny. So, that's how it is in basketball, man. That's how it's been. It's just different now because it's legal. But, I agree with you. I thought, Matt, you know, last year that the GG thing turned out to be a net positive because of what he's doing in the NBA with the Grizzlies and how he does continue to show the program love. That's why, despite, you know, the team not being that good, there were some good things that happened Lamont's first year. You know, I think everybody kind of didn't recognize it because you had an 18-win team that lost a bunch of players and dropped to 11, and you know it wasn't this hire that set off a bunch of fireworks. But you got GG Jackson here; he's now in the NBA doing quite well with a bright future. And they did beat Clemson, and they did win at Rupp, and they did beat Georgia at home, which is always important. You don't want to start a losing streak to the mighty NIT battle-tested Bulldogs, right? So, you know, and they showed some signs of life. They took Alabama was number two in the country, took them to the wire, took Arkansas to the wire. You know, they had some good moments. I just think we didn't realize it because I think after that tournament in Charleston where you saw Nico Medved, Colorado State, dismantle them, and Furman dismantled them, and Davidson dismantled them in three straight days over Thanksgiving, you're like, Beavis? I don't know what we got in. You know, I mean, and so – But there were some signs last year. Nobody could have predicted it. But I think that's the bottom line there. And you're right. And that'll help you get in the door. But I do think that the most important thing beyond cash and beyond all that is going to be, and this is all about Paris is going to recruit. He's going to recruit for his system. South Carolina is now a system program. Like it, love it, want some more of it, hate it, whatever. You know, South Carolina is not in a position, success or not, and even as long as Lamont's here, he's not going to do it. But they're not in a position to go McDonald's. And they're not in one. You know, and compared to the rest of the SEC, and I'll throw Oklahoma and Texas in there too, you know, they're still like 15th, you know, out of 16 as far as which of these programs is attractive to you as a basketball recruit. People, it's going to be hard for people to hear that. But when you're talking about the best of the best, though, you know, you'll see Alabama snag one, Auburn will snag one, a couple, Mississippi State sometimes. You know, LSU's done that before. South Carolina's just not a place, even when they have players in state, they don't do it. So right now, you got to swim upstream while everybody else is going downstream. And you got to have a system and guys that fit that system and play it like very, very well, like this year's team did. Now, can they be more talented next year? Absolutely. More athletic, that kind of thing? Absolutely. But I think, you know, as we enter into a very non-traditional period in college athletics, nobody needs to get caught up in star ratings, McDonald's All-Americans, people like that when it comes to Lamont Paris and how he's going to build this program. He's building it a different way. And that's everything else has not worked. So let's try something. You try something different. You win 26 games your second year. Go to the tournament for only the sixth time in 50. I think you're doing something right, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that this team next year has opportunity to be even better on defense, which is, you know, important because, you know, say what you want about Michi, and he was a dog and he was able to get, you know, almost to steal a game, but he was a little undersized. But BJ Mack, for everything he did on offense, there were some games when he gave it all the way back on defense, just gave opponents the opportunity to score. But the other thing Lamont has to sell here is there's close to 40 points per game that have left the team this year. So when you go talk to players that might be at the mid-major power five level, Gamecocks are going to need some scorers next year. Colin Murray-Boyles can't do it all. I think that you can see Colin, you know, flirt with 15, 16, 18 points a game, 8 rebounds a game. I think that Zach Davis could be a, you know, 10 to 14 point per game scorer. But outside of that, you know, they're going to have to find some more guys that can put it in the basket. And I think that they will. And, you know, one of the things that kind of goes unnoticed here is, you know, how well the Gamecocks played defensively down the stretch once Colin Murray-Boyles was healthy. And the sky is the limit for that kid. I mean, he's going to be a first-team preseason All-SEC guy next year. And that's something to build off of right there. So we'll see what happens. I'm excited for this next little run. I don't know exactly how long the portal window is open in college basketball. I think it's 45 days. I think it's 45 days, and then, you know, it's already open right now. But the teams that continue to play in March, there's 2 more weekends. There are going to be some guys that leave those teams as well. So just keep an eye on it. Keep plugged into thebigspur.com. You know, the VIP room's great on Monday nights. There's a huge information dump this past Monday. But, you know, this stuff happens quickly, and as soon as the name pops up, you'll be able to find it on the Big Spur.
I thought I had a lot of football stuff this this time around, and John does a great job of tracking the basketball and all that. The VIP's good. If you're not VIP – most of you are that listen to this show, but I think you could join for $1 if you want to just join for $1 and track the basketball, then tell us to go crazy. The other thing about it is if you join and you pay full price, like you just sign up for the $9.99 a month or however much it is, you get Paramount Plus. So if the wife likes to watch Yellowstone or whatever, you know, on Paramount Plus, she can't tell you to cancel the Big Spur. Because I do that. That's, you know, that's the number one reason I get as far as people canceling, other than the people are crying in their oatmeal because of a loss or something. And then those people always come back. It's that, man, the wife just won't let me pay for it anymore. She's mad. It's not the money either. It's usually that the man is on the site all the time.
Jason, I would love to know how many times a day each user logs into the Big Spur or refreshes the page, because I mean, I do it like 100 times a day.
We got a loyal group, man. I mean, we really do. They get on my boy yesterday. I was just wanting to choke some people. And I know I got fired up earlier today about the McElwain situation, but I love them all. I mean, they're good people, you know. Flo Bird, he calls me out today, just now, when we're on the break. Oh, the owner of this site defended Justin Stepp every step of the way, and I told you he was terrible. So no, I'll still defend it based on like reality. Around here, we tend to think everything's either good or terrible. You know, that's a very 3-year-old way to look at things, right? Life and reality aren't normally like that. And what I've always said about Stepp is, were things perfect? Could they have been better? Yeah, you know, were there some recruiting things that didn't go his way? Yeah, absolutely. Did he do a hell of a job with what he had at receiver most years he was here, all 3 years? Yeah, he improved the room. And to me, that's what makes a good assistant coach. Now, there's a reason he got moved around. I mean, I don't know that Shane Beamer shared my opinion. Yeah. I know Justin's going to do a good job at Illinois, though. You know, and so, yeah, I'm going to defend a guy like that. You know, I'm not going to defend a guy like Brian McClendon, who brings in 230-pound receivers and expects them to run with SEC defensive backs. I'm not going to defend Steve Spurrier Jr. for the, you know, most of the guys he really liked were not that good. And the guys he ended up coaching that were NFL players were guys other people had to make him recruit, right? Hell of a coach, though. But Justin, I'm not going to sit here and pile on Justin Stepp, man. You're freaking crazy. Because Kelton Henderson left, the international man of mystery. But anyway, my point is, I love all those guys. I mean, you know, it's kind of a big sports bar where everybody kind of knows who, you know, you have a lot of regulars. And so that's the deal. So
yeah, it's a 24/7 sports bar. We'd rather you take your anger out on and keeping your dog.
Clint, I completely disagree. It didn't improve the room as a whole. The room as a whole was a hole. It was a hole of butts. It was the worst in Power 5 football when he took over. Who did they have? They had Josh Vann, who had no confidence. They had Jalen Brooks, who had no confidence. A very raw Xavier Leggett. I mean, EJ Jenkins. I mean, that 2021 team, really, Jaheim Bell, I guess, was technically a tight end, plus a complete moron. You know, I mean, look, he got Juice Wells here, didn't he? Yeah. He made Jalen Brooks really, really good, didn't he? Yeah. Got Josh Vann better, didn't he? Yeah. Developed Xavier Leggett, yeah. You know?
Well, the big issue, JC, is that, you know, we live in just, you know, mindset that every freshman that I've paid attention to and got attached to over 9 months in the recruiting process has to be, you know, All-American their first year. Like, there's still development that happens in football. Football, for my money, is the most developmental sport on the planet. And to JC's point, the development of those wide receivers, he gets credit for that. Absolutely.
You have to. I mean, now look, I think Tyshawn and Russell will end up being a pretty good find. I think with what he had to work with Nick Harbor last year, you know, he got him to the point where he could catch 6 passes for 90 yards in an SEC game. Is that not a good coach? I don't know. I'm sorry. Would you rather have Brian McClendon back? He's with the Dolphins now. I mean, would you rather? I mean, seriously. We want to go call it BMAC up and start recruiting 215-pound dudes that look like running backs that are too short to be tight ends and too slow to play receivers. Is that what we want? We can arrange that. I mean, now look, I mean, was it perfect? No. Do I wish he'd have landed more guys? Yeah, but I think this is a situation a lot like Sean Elliott where there was one poster on the board with revisionist history when it came to Sean, because he only watched the Gamecocks play football in 2015 and 2016. Obviously, had no context at any other time. Elliott couldn't recruit. Elliott can't do this. Elliott can't do that. Well, when Elliott left, the recruiting in general on the roster had gone downhill. There was only 20 guys that could play in the SEC on the whole freaking roster. Hey, who was in charge of recruiting? Oh, I don't know. Guess. And there were some guys that weren't that good. I'll be honest. We go talk to John Strickland about it tomorrow. But then you look back, guess it, he left behind Dennis Daly. Pretty good player, NFL guy, right? Sadarius Hutcherson, 3-year starter, one of the best guys. You know, he found him. Donnell Stanley, who sat for a couple of years but ended up being more than solid. Zach Bailey, who got a cup of coffee in the NFL that was, by all accounts, was pretty good. And then say what you want about Eric Douglas, probably not my favorite player. Never thought he was an All-American, but, you know, there's a reason he started for 3 or 4 years and obviously was one of those guys that, you know, was important with the 2-game run last season. So he left behind a pretty good bit. And then you look at all the guys before, early in his tenure that he put in the NFL, Brandon Shell, AJ Cann. He didn't recruit a lot of those guys, but, you know, T.J. Johnson was a I believe, a John Hunt recruit, but he got him in the NFL. He got the most out of Kyle Nunn, for goodness sake. Nunn did not play in the NFL, but he started. He took Rokevious Watkins from a 360-pounder to a road grader in 2010, then a left tackle in 2011. You know, and so, the criticisms of Elliott's offensive line when he left were probably valid because of the situation. And you're going to look at that with Justin Stepp's receiving corps now, too. But I think in time we may see, oh, gosh, he left all these guys behind it. It'll be pretty good.
Well, think about this. You know, when he gives Stepp credit for Mazio Bennett, who was signed, sealed, and delivered to Tennessee, Stepp kept working him, got him to flip back to South Carolina or flip to South Carolina. Nobody talks about that. And those are the kinds of players that he finished second to so many times. Elite wide receivers that literally South Carolina finished second because of the offense and because of the name on the front of the jersey. But building relationships, he was a heck of a relationship builder with these high school recruits.
Yeah, you know, and we'll see. We'll see how good, you know, we'll see how good some of these guys turn out. Clint talks about evaluations. Yeah, that's tough. I mean, because you sort of look at Landon Sampson. That wasn't an evaluation. That was a guy that was kind of a ready-made guy. But some people just don't want to – they get up to the next level, and they don't want any, no matter how good they are in high school. They peak in high school, you know. That's why I never say if a guy's a 4 or 5-star, you don't anoint them and pay them and throw parades for them, because that's like, you know, naming somebody that won most likely to succeed the president of the United States. There's work to be done after high school. No, I'm glad I didn't peak in high school, right? I know some people that did. Feel bad for them. But some people do, and then in football, and then they don't want any. So that's what happened there. And then, you know, the extreme other end of the spectrum, Horton was the ultimate upside guy from, you know, 8-man football. Clemson liked him in camp. Clemson just didn't have a need for him. Virginia Tech offered him. I mean, he's 6'4", could run. That guy was going to take some time, but I guess he didn't go fast enough. So, I mean, those are two misses in evaluation technically, but you can see the logic behind it. You're not going out there recruiting a guy that's 6'4", just because he looks like Sidney Rice that can't play dead in a movie, or a 225-pound guy that's never going to be fast enough because he's already so big. Yeah, you know, those are the types of things that get to me. And then, you know, we'll see too. There are about 2 or 3 guys in the state this year that left the state. Those are NC State and elsewhere. Now, if those guys end up being legit, then there is some criticism that needs to take place. So we'll see. Steph's gone. I really like Fury. I liked Coley to a certain extent as well. You know, I didn't know about receiver, but, you know, we'll see what happens. But I just don't want to. I don't want to sit here and pile on a guy. And I think in general, this program, every one of us, you know, unless somebody sucks, you know, it's never, oh, they were great or they sucked. It's never we're doomed because they leave, or that we're going to be so much better because they left because they suck. That's not reality. And I think we're all a little better than that. Anyway, yeah,
you got to think that the health of your program is what you're calling into question there. If you're like one single person. leaves and it's sunk. It's like, you know, your program's never that bad off. I mean, some may be, you know, one guy leaves and next thing you know, I mean, I don't know what Duke's going to be next year.
After, man, they make a, I don't know that they made a good hire either in Manny Diaz.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Eric asked any names Paris has contacted. The Doug kid from Michigan, safe to say, and Pegues from Furman, I think, safe to say, right? There's a kid I've kind of got under my hat, and I don't know if he's going to get in the portal or not, but that I'm kind of waiting to talk about. He's a big man. But, yeah, they my understanding is they met as a staff 2 days ago and kind of started putting some things together. So we should have some info soon. Keep in mind, basketball staff, basketball folks, they work differently than football. It's not the visits and stuff aren't as public. Many times we don't know who's coming in, who's not, that type of thing. And they do it on purpose because you got different strategies there and different levels.
About 100 other schools that be interested in the player.
1 million schools. Yeah. So, all right. So, do we need a break here, Phil, or are we going to wait?
We can take a quick timeout here. I got a short one we could throw at him, and then do a little brief segment before Derek hops in with us here at 1:40.
Mm-hmm. Let's freaking go! This is Inside the Gamecocks, the show built by the Barndo Co. We'll be right back.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons, and so the resurrection of it. You know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barndo Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned, Gamecock operated. The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to Signarama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpeper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, three great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
Left me here to weep.
Welcome back, everybody, inside the Gamecocks, the show. Matt Anderson joining JC and Phil here. JB will be back tomorrow. Had a little something he had to take care of. And, of course, Derek Scott joins us here in about 7 minutes or so, guys. So let's keep it a little tight here. That way we can have a clean transition and hit all the breaks today.
That's always positive.
It is a good thing. We've done it. This will be 2 days.
JB will be proud of us.
Well, we can do something quick here. I saw that Miller on ESPN put up a 7-round mock draft. Had Xavier Leggett going 33rd overall to the Carolina Panthers, and then Spencer Rattler going in the 4th round to the New England Patriots. And I hate both of those landing spots.
Now, is 33, does that 2-1, or is there compensatory 2-1. At the end
I think,
of 1?
I think this year's 2-1.
132, okay. Yeah,
right. Tell the Panthers to quit drafting Carolina's players.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, leave them alone. Let them thrive. I wouldn't go to Carolina and play in Charlotte for David Tepper for Tepper's money at this point. I mean, you just don't know if you're going to be able to. The money better be right to go up into a bad situation like that. You know, it's just awful.
My dream scenario for Spencer is to end up either with the Rams with McVay. I think he'd be great there if McVay decides to keep coaching. Or I'd love to see Spencer in Denver with Sean Payton. I think that Denver would be an elite landing spot, unfortunately, unless Denver shares the same thoughts as our inside the Gamecocks draft expert. They might be picking a quarterback earlier in the draft and trading.
Nobody does. I mean, unfortunately, because I see where that guy's coming from. I mean, yeah, to be honest. Mark says he wants Spencer in Atlanta. Yeah, dude, Kirk Cousins, man. What world are we living in? And see, this is my theory. We have a couple of posters that agree with me on Big Spur that don't agree with me. The NFL, there's so many bad quarterbacks in the NFL, dude. When we're in a world where Kirk Cousins is your savior, Phil's a Washington fan.
I know. He was not the savior in Washington. He was just fortunate that guy was on the bench when RG3 went down. And of course, I hate the way that happened because we basically ran his knee into nothing and ended his career. So,
yeah, that's what I like about Lamar Jackson. You know, lots of longevity with him as a runner, running quarterback. Can't seem to get over the hump. But, you know, Michael Vick had injury issues too for a while, but had a nice long career. I mean, he was never quite as dynamic after that first year. I mean, I remember the Falcons, like his first year he was a starter. They went to the playoffs. They beat this is the early 2000s. They beat the Saints on the road. They ran into somebody good. And then the next year, Dan Reeves comes back and hype is through the roof. And he gets injured in a preseason game. Achilles out for the year. I don't even know who they were playing at quarterback. They finished – they ended up firing Dan Reeves with 3 games to go, Wade Phillips. I mean, it was bad.
Yeah.
He comes back, and they got to the NFC Championship game 1 year, but he was a lot different type of guy. So RG3, yeah, you're absolutely right. But –
Mike Fitzgerald, man, was just a thing of beauty to Deshaun Jackson when he played for the Eagles. Sorry.
Oh, Phil. Yeah.
It was a thing. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But no, I'm a Falcons guy. You know, before I adopted the Bears and decided to take on a life of misery, I had that life of misery. And so I want them to do well. I think they've done a good job acquiring talent. But why are we in a world where Kirk Cousins is – I mean, he's got, like, this record contract. People are accusing the Falcons of tampering. I mean, I'm like, it's Kirk Cousins.
I know.
And I get back to the fact – you're talking about a league that drafted Mitch Trubisky number 1 overall, ahead of Deshaun Watson and Patrick Mahomes. You're talking about a league that – made Jamarcus Russell the top pick in the draft. You're talking about who's the kid from Central Florida a few years back? Blake Bortles?
Bortles, made him
into the savior of a franchise. You know, you're also talking about a league that drafted Tom Brady in the 5th round and Russell Wilson in the 4th. I mean, you know, and the guy that damn near won the Super Bowl this year was Mr. Irrelevant, Brock Purdy. So and these guys have, unlike recruiting guys, which they bat about the same percentage we did, you know, they have millions of dollars. They get to get, if they need to go fly to Kalamazoo, Michigan, and interview the janitor at the middle school and ask him about player B, they can. They can pull records. They can test them over and over. They can see. I mean, they got all the game film. That just shows you how hard it is to evaluate this game. I mean, it's just because a lot of times it comes down to what's in the chest and what's between the ears.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, unless Elon Musk succeeds in putting brain chips on all of us, that's going to be really hard to determine about a human being. That's one thing that, you know, because our souls and our essence and who we are, you can't dig into somebody that way. All right.
People have a real good way of showing who they are, you know, when you're not necessarily watching them perform on the field. I think that's one of the things that Daniel Kelly with first round mock kind of reminds us of too.
Especially when it comes to Caleb Williams,
who's right.
Definitely Chicago bound. You know, we up here we've gone from a game changing mixed use, multi acre Chicago Bears theme park type mixed use development dome in Arlington Heights to staying downtown next to the lake, where the museums are, and replicating Soldier Field. And we've gone from trading Justin Fields for a great quarterback and a bunch of draft picks and all that to drafting Caleb Williams and getting a 6-round pick for Justin.
Yeah, well, that's a hell of an art museum down there, though, JC.
But yeah, I just don't like the people that run it.
No, I know.
Because they George Lucas was going to build the George Lucas Star Wars Museum there, and it was too Star Wars. It was too touristy for them. Oh well, Jeeves, I'm so sorry. I mean, this is the city that literally a Polish sausage on a bun with grilled onions cooked outside is a delicacy. This is the city where everything has sausage on it. This is a city where old style is a luxury beer. Yet, oh, God bless. No, we can't have George Lucas here, can we?
Nope, too much.
Get cap, George Lucas beers.
Brats. Well, let's hit a break. We got Derek Scott coming up.
All on the sausage. Side of
this one.
Pork chaps.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Touchdown Brewer. Set up a screen and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown Brewer, his second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer. Turns the corner. Touchdown, number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right, you know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service, second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer. Ryan Brewer Fence. The website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina, and we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man,
The building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Here we are back with the man that we know as The Voice, also known as apparently Stuart Lake's agent, which may explain some things. Welcome in, Derek Scott. Good. I'll admit, Derek, I did not listen to you and Stu last night because I was listening to Grayson Griner on his first appearance on television. What a terrible game to have your first experience on having to call a game, right?
Oh, actually, it's perfect because you got to realize it's not always easy and it's not always fun. And so, that's a great opportunity for Grayson to have the reality check of what it really can be like. So now he'll decide from that if he wants to come back or not.
Yeah, that's right. Might as well be a baptism by fire in that situation.
Yeah. So on that note, Derek, riddle me this. So you guys, and different people do it different ways. We had Tim Brando on JC and Morgan yesterday, and he showed us one of his prep sheets from an NCAA basketball tournament game, handwritten. Very impressive. Timmy B. It's Timmy B, though. He's a legend. And old school. So do you guys, when you call baseball, do you keep score like the old school scorebook, like 4-3 out, E6? Do you keep score like that while you're calling the game, or do you, how do you approach that? Because I know a lot of people that'll do that anyway. But how do you do it?
Most people still do it, I would say. I cut ties from that a couple of years ago just to experiment for a while with just using the live stats. So in my mind, if I've got live stats available on the laptop in front of me, do I really need to keep my own book? Now, I guarantee you, there are lots of people who would like just shudder at the thought of not doing it because they want that record in their hands that they can come back to for past games and constantly be able just to go back through their book. That's why I say I think I'm probably in the minority. But with the way things shape up now, missing the games I miss at the beginning of the season anyway with basketball, I kind of feel like I don't know that having that is really all that complete anymore for me. So I've shifted into the live stats, just having the stat broadcast up in front of me at all times, and it's working for me for now at least. I'm not feeling like I'm, you know, without my security blanket, but there are a lot of folks I know who still live and die with that thing in that manner if they're doing it, you know, for every game for a squad.
I was going to say last night's scorebook, if you were keeping score, but a scorebook.
There were so many times where I thought we were not going to play nine innings. I thought we were not going to play nine innings for weather. I thought we were not going to play nine innings for a run rule. And as it turns out, we were there for all of it. And got almost 4 hours worth of fun and frivolity.
Got the nine in, huh? Before we kind of dive into baseball, Gamecocks, of course, are on the road starting tomorrow at Sewell Thomas Stadium in Tuscaloosa. Just pulled up a picture. They remodeled this ballpark in 2016. It needed it. Nice looking ballpark down there, and a nice trip. I like going to T-Town. Kind of just to put a bow on basketball, and very disappointing loss, obviously, for everybody. But, you know, it's been a week. You sort of look back. Big picture-wise, your take on this season, on the Meechie Johnson – departure, on what's important this offseason to sustain this for Laurent Paris and company. Just give us your, you know, big global view of the state of Gamecock men's basketball.
Sure. This season was a rousing success. I don't see how anybody could view it in any other capacity. When you set the school record or tie the school record for wins, that speaks to its significance. When you do that coming off of a previous season where you had 21 losses, that's even more noteworthy. The way this group played, I think it was good in terms of setting the tone for expectations of how Coach Paris is going to run his program. The style of play, the rotations, the structure of the roster, I think all of that was very telling for what he wants this program to be. So I think that's good because fans can see it. They can, you know, taste it and understand what the expectations will be moving forward. And that, I think, is beneficial. The game didn't bother me so much insofar as the NCAA tournament's all about matchups. It's not necessarily about seeding. It is about matchups. And when you draw in a 6-11 game, that rare 11 seed that comes from a power conference, there's a reason they're in there. If you don't think they were poorly seeded, which I don't think they were, I think they were fitting for an 11 seed, then that means something changed over the course of the year. They are getting in as an automatic bid if they're an 11 seed from a major conference, most likely, as was the case with Oregon. And in their instance, that was a roster that's much better than an 11 seed roster. It's just it was not playing with a full deck of cards most of the season. They were missing so many guys, important guys, for a lot of games. What you saw is not a typical 11 seed team. And so that just, you know, it just was a bad matchup. I mean, I don't think there's any other way to spin it. Would it have been nice for Colin to be 100% and have his full energy? Absolutely. But Jermaine Cousinard was a tough matchup for our guards. And Dante was just a nightmare for our bigs. And so, yeah, you hate that it went down the way it did, but for this team to shoot threes as well as they did in that game and to still not be able to be in it late just tells you what, you know, sometimes it's just not your day, and that's a matchup that sets itself up to not be your day, unfortunately, for the game. It wasn't like a Coppin State loss on the last pitch. It was just a bad matchup for a 6-11 game, and sometimes you just got to wear it.
Or like Lamont losing by a point to Illinois on that same floor 2 years ago in a heartbreaker where they outplayed them the whole game. It almost would have been better if Carolina had fallen to a 7. Well, because those 10 seeds were not – I don't – if you look at the 11s overall, NC State and Duquesne kind of went against the grain and were – I mean, NC State's still red hot.
Right.
Duquesne won. Oregon won. You know, I don't know why. Washington State got through. Colorado and Florida was very competitive. I mean, I don't know. Maybe 7 would have been a blessing in disguise.
Well, you know, JC, it's interesting you say that. Oh, sorry, Derek.
No, go ahead, man.
It's interesting you say that because this is the first year that I ever remember 10 seeds having playing games. I haven't seen that.
Yeah, that was new. And,
you know, when you talk about 5 bid thieves, like what the committee said happened, normally those bid thieves, especially from the Power 5 level, are in that playing game. And normally that's an 11 seed. Normally it's an 11 seed. And you think about the difference, and it's a coin flip, 50-50. The Gamecocks are a 6 seed, Oregon's an 11, but they would still have to play a game 2 days prior and then play again. That didn't happen this year.
That was so weird. There was no play-in on the 11 line. That is something different. But, yeah, go ahead, Derek.
What I was going to say was, if I can remember what the heck I was going to say, was that your top – you kept hearing a lot of this, that the way it was structured is the top 4, the top 8 maybe. There was a pretty significant gap between the top and everybody else. And then below that line, man, it was a jumbled mess. There wasn't a big gap. And it's played out that way. I mean, the fact that all of your 1s and 2s are in the Sweet 16 for the first time in a long time tells you that that bears fruit. And then the fact that there was still plenty of turmoil in the first 2 days of the tournament, it just happened below that line. Then that's also, I think, noteworthy. But yeah, you're right. 6-11 was the new 5-12. And it's kind of come off that way the last 2 years. But still, even saying that, I would have rather taken my chances with Duquesne or McNeese State or someone of that nature than measuring up with a team that had the tools and the weapons Oregon has. And I'm biased. I'll admit it, but I'm going to tell you this. You were matched up with a Hall of Fame coach. Dana Altman doesn't lose the first weekend very often. He certainly doesn't lose on the first day. There's a reason for that. I was talking to a good friend of mine who's a coach at a mid-major, and he told me that on the front end. He said, man, that stinks. I said, what about it? You like them that much? He said, well, I like Dana Altman. Say, you know, that's not the guy I would have wanted to draw straight out of the chute, and that matchup zone you're going to have to fool with. And all of that was
matchup zone was great. Altman had not lost in the first round, by the way, since 07.
Yeah.
And I didn't go, he didn't go every single year, but every year he's been. And in Oregon, I think this was the first year he did not make at least a Sweet 16 at Oregon, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe his first year he's won or two and done, but
he hasn't made the Sweet 16, but he's won the first round game every time.
It's something like eight straight in the first round. All right, switching gears to baseball because we're up against it here. Yeah, that's a crazy thing. So baseball, I think there's always darkness before the dawn around here, it seems. And, you know, you come out of that with a big hangover. I know I had a figurative and a literal hangover on Friday. And then the game got rained out. So you got more pain. You got to nurse your pain Friday, you know. But the sun came up Saturday, and lo and behold, the boys of summer came alive. Derek, talk about that and kind of, you know, how this team has, you know, not to anybody's shock or surprise, but it looks like they're kind of getting it together and evolving. And baseball is a season of streakiness, and looks like the Gamecocks are on an uptick now.
Well, when I went down for the pregame interview with Coach Kingston, I told him, I said, well, I'm back, so just let's calm down. We got this, don't we? And you better believe I tried to claim credit for everything good that's happened since then. The weird thing was, of course, this season up to that point had been the opposite of what we all thought, which was pitching had been really, really solid and consistent. Bats had not been. And that was not the way we approached the season in terms of expectations. Proving once again, you don't know. You don't know until you play. And even then, you might think you figured out, and then it can change on you over the course of a month or a season. But you know, I thought that moving that Friday game to Saturday would not be beneficial to the Gamecocks. Turned out it was great. There were some things at play there that stood out to me. First of all, the fact that Vanderbilt was as sloppy as they were. Did not expect them to struggle as much just to catch the ball. The wind was a factor and a few of their miscues, but both teams were playing in the same conditions. So that certainly doesn't allow you a free pass on that. The second thing that stands out to me is after you finish watching three games, you go, you know what? We've got as much pitching as they do. And that's not normally what you say after a Vanderbilt series. You're usually shaking your head almost in frustration that there they go again, running dudes out of the bullpen that all look like the same guy, that are all 6'4 with broad shoulders and wearing some goofy number in the 70s or 80s and throwing everything 95 and above. And then it wasn't there. I mean, the first part of it was there. But they didn't have anything, you know, in that rotation or in that bullpen that South Carolina didn't match. That is really encouraging to me. And I, you know, as it evolved, I wasn't thinking as much about it until it was over. Then you think back on it, you go, who did they have that you'd say, oh, dude, let me have that guy. I'll give you whoever you want in return. I'm not sure who that would have been. I mean, their Friday guy's plenty good, but he's not like the typical Vandy Friday aces of the past where you just might as well start with thinking about dinner reservations. And so – that's really encouraging. And then watching Ethan Petrie come alive the way he did, man, I'm just so excited right now about where he is. And again, I was away for a while, so I may not have seen some of the struggles, certainly in Oxford, but he's not chasing because most folks don't want to pitch to him. He's not chasing. And then when you do pitch to him, he is punishing baseballs. I mean, if you throw him fastballs in any count, hitters count or not, he is doing some real damage, and that's, you know, when you've got that one guy, everything else, you know, that's going to lift up some other guys because it takes some pressure off of other guys. And it just feels like it's starting, some pieces are starting to fall into place because Kennedy Jones, who we were also excited about when he came in out of the portal, and then he just wasn't the guy in the fall that everybody expected him to be, to the point that he wasn't even in the starting lineup opening weekend. Now you look back and go, well, I'm glad we didn't screw around with that any longer than 3 or 4 days because he's a dude.
Two years in a row, Petrie was not in the lineup last year and Jones was not in the lineup this year. But that's just baseball, though, guys. I mean, you know, some guys, and I think in baseball especially, there's such a thing as a gamer. You know, a guy that maybe is not as good in practice as Ray Tanner coached some of those, I'm sure. But Alabama ranked higher than I expected this year, especially after Gamblegate and all that. I kind of thought they'd be a team that was down toward the bottom. I mean, they kind of rallied last year and made the tournament.
Unregional last year.
Yeah, this is not the most difficult place to play. Has it been historically? I remember Chad Holbrook's team wrapping up the East over there a couple years ago, but – What challenges do they present from where you sit?
You know, it'd be interesting to see because they've had the same start that everybody else has, really good at home and weirdly bad on the road. I mean, God, they got swept at Georgia. No one saw that coming. But they'd already won 2 or 3 against Tennessee, and I know they were feeling really good about themselves after that. I think they've only lost 1 home game all season. However, JC, to your point, I don't think of that stadium as particularly intimidating. In spite of how well they're playing at home. But they've got pieces, but they're new pieces because, like you said, after the mess last year, new coaching staff came on board and a lot of guys got out of there, as is the case with coaching changes nowadays. But, man, they've done a good job of finding pieces in a lot of places. Their best two hitters right now are third baseman Gage Miller, who they pulled out of the JUCO ranks, the old-fashioned transfer portal. And then the new-fashioned transfer portal – is the outfielder that they got from Ole Miss, McCants, who he always looked like, you know, just a million-dollar future guy and didn't consistently show that in games. And in this, his final season, he looks it again. He's really playing well for them. They've got some real good pieces. They don't have anything, I don't think, that overwhelms you. But then when you look at the numbers, it's like, well, they're leading the league in hitting. And there's got to be a good reason for that. That can't be all about two guys. Pitching is interesting. Their Friday guy looked like he was going to be a legit SEC Friday guy, but now his first two conference starts have not been great. And then they've got some guys in behind him who they've had to kind of plug in. They got a left-hander that transferred in from Louisville who's pitched well for them so far. We'll see him, I think, on Saturday, maybe Sunday. I forget the order they're working with there. But, I mean, yeah, they're a lot like South Carolina in so far as – they've got guys that have, that have produced here or other places and at times this year have looked like, a really strong lineup. And even the losses at Georgia weren't based on offensive struggles so much as they were on pitching. So I'm more anxious than anything to see, since South Carolina's swinging the bats pretty well right now, how that matchup looks. And then, of course, what kind of a factor is the fact that both teams didn't play until Saturday last week and have to turn around and play Thursday this week? How do you structure your pitching? You know, I know Stu was on with you guys earlier, and he was talking about Eli's campaign efforts to make sure he still gets the start tomorrow night. And, you know, what's Alabama going to do? What's new head coach Rob Vaughn going to do with that very same scenario? Because they, too, were rained out on Friday in Athens and played 2 on Saturday.
If he were to not start Eli, Derek, who do you think gets the nod? I mean, because after what we saw last night, I mean, that was 7 guys who could have that. Copper started, so you're not going to do that, you know?
Yeah. That was the problem with that game going as long as it did. I mean, don't get me wrong. They wanted to get some guys some innings that hadn't gotten to pitch yet or hadn't gotten to pitch much yet. And they did, unfortunately, for a couple of them. It was a little bit of a rocky road. But then again, whoever you sent out there last night seemed to have problems throwing strikes. And maybe that – you know, what was the common theme with all those guys on the mound? It was the dude behind the plate. And I'm not talking about Ethan Reeves.
No.
I'm talking about the umpire that Mr. Stuart and I said as the game started, I looked at him, I said, so I don't know the guy behind the plate. And he said, I don't either. And I thought, well, that's not great. I much prefer if I just was the one that didn't know who he was as opposed to Stu not knowing him either. And he seemed like he was trying to prove a point that I'm ready for this level and I'm not going to give anybody a quarter inch on either corner. And it did not affect the flow of the game in a positive manner at all.
No.
Mr. Trackman, bring me a dream.
Got it.
Anyway, all right, Derek, so we'll let you run on that. Alabama baseball this year, I get an Ole Miss men's basketball vibe from this team. Just kind of – that's probably a gut feeling. They'll probably sweep the Gamecocks this weekend. I'll look like an idiot. But, new coach, not terribly high expectations, better than expected. But I kind of feel like Carolina's better. Carolina's got better arms. I'll take a team that can hit it against a team with good pitching that also can hit the ball most days. But what do I know? It's baseball.
You know what? It could very easily come down to what it oftentimes came down to last weekend, and that is who throws and catches it cleanly.
Yeah, like, who makes the plays in the field.
That was the difference. Honestly, that was as big a difference in that Vanderbilt series as anything. So.
Exactly. Well, safe travels down to T-Town, man. Keep working hard. We'll be listening, and we'll catch up with you next week, brother.
All right, guys. Take care.
Thanks, Derek.
Scott. Matt, any final thoughts?
I see Craig asked about the weather in Tuscaloosa. I'm looking at it right now. Thursday, partly cloudy, 67 high, 38 low. Friday, partly cloudy, 71 high, 48 low. And Saturday, partly cloudy, 75 high and 56 degree low. So good baseball weather.
No more rainouts, dude.
I know. This season has been so affected by weather, at least especially the home games. Just it's awful. Let's let the sun come out and enjoy some damn peanuts and beer here.
Don't make me make a climate change.
That's right.
Hey, what did I say? April showers bring May flowers. It's just a month early. We have had March showers this year.
That's right. Well, I always go back to the whole is like March either comes in like a lamb and goes out like a lion, or goes in like a lion and out like a lamb. You know,
does
all that old head stuff? Yeah. Oh yeah.
In the South, there's been some of that. I tell Matt all the time. There's one week in the South in March where it's cold as hell and usually snows, and then it's like over. You know, it's like okay, it's like winter. Like got up for one final battle.
Yep, and we just went through that.
Just
went through that last little blast, which I was glad did not get down below freezing. Thank goodness. But that's what the old heads will tell you is like you can't count winter out till Easter.
Can't keep answering me right now. Come on down, everybody. Come on, you can't go. My foot hurts. I think it's gonna snow. Well, give me some milk and bread. Anyway. Matt, thank you. Phil, thank you. I'll thank myself. Like from the producers, how myself. It's been fun. I'm in a much better mood than I was
earlier. I turned it around.
I got up off the mat like old man winter. Happy birthday to Dina, one of my dearest friends. I hope you have a wonderful day. Phil, I hope you guys have a great day. Yeah. And we'll be back tomorrow. JB will be back. I forget who we have. Who we have tomorrow?
John Strickland tomorrow.
Oh, and Mike Morgan.
We wrap the week up.
If you have not listened to the Late Night Gamecock show, it is on our YouTube channel and also should be on our podcast channel. So go check out Matt and Alex Jones going at it. Lots of great insight there, basketball and other sports. I'm going to try to be sunshine and rainbows tomorrow. I'm going to concentrate on my attitude. So for Phil Mullinax, the Mad Dog, for Matty Ice Anderson of the Late Night Gamecock Show, or the Late Night Gamecock, this is JC Emmer Efren Sherbert, and we will see you tomorrow on Inside the Gamecock Show.